This podcast is brought to you by patreon.com/talkingsimpsons. Head there to check out exclusive podcasts like Talking Futurama, Talk King of the Hill, the What a Cartoon Movie podcast, and tons more.
I heartily endorse this event or product.
Ahoy hoy everybody, and welcome to Talking Simpsons, a piece of non-claptrap that never makes you want to retch. I'm your host, the seething cauldron of rage and recrimination, Bob Mackey, and this is our chronological exploration of The Simpsons. Who is here with me today, as always?
Bantering Jack in the Box, Henry Gilbert.
And who is our special guest on the line?
But brother, it ain't ketchup. Steven Sajdak is here from the We Hate Movies podcast.
And this week's episode is Black Widower.
It's like they saw our lives and put it right up on screen.
This episode originally aired on April 9th, 1992, and as always, Henry will tell us what happened on this mythical day in real world history.
Oh boy, Bobby, Stephen King's Sleepwalkers is number one at the box office.
What?
Barney and Friends debuts on PBS, and John Gotti is convicted of a murder.
Whoa.
Yes. This?
The murder of Barney, perhaps.
Wow. The fact that Sleepwalkers actually won the box office for 1 week alone is shocking to me.
I mean, you know, it's April. It's an empty time. This is back when there were like two movies would release in April, pretty much.
We used to be a proper country, I guess, is the idea.
Yeah, right after the Oscars, you're just seeing Best Picture. Mm. I certainly didn't see Sleepwalkers in theaters. It was a classic weekend rental with the pals in high school. And you just see the branding, like Stephen King Sleepwalkers. Hey, it's Stephen King. Can't go wrong there. It is a weird one. He was in a real cat people era at that time. Because this isn't the only... When I think of like, oh, it's the cat people one. No, not that one. The other cat people one.
This is a Mick Garris collaboration, though, who he worked with a lot.
Oh, yeah, yeah. He's the Stanley Tong to his Jackie Chan, I'd say. Mm-hmm. I just watched Super Cop, so that's my mind. The way I remember Sleepwalkers, though, it's not just... that they are people besieged by cats. It's that they are an incestuous son and mother.
Yes.
Who are besieged by cats.
And it's got the scariest woman who ever lived, Alice Krege, in it. Speaking of Star Trek, which we were just talking about off the air. Yeah, I think I would run the other way if I saw Alice Krege. I'm sure she's a totally lovely person, but she scares the shit out of me.
And yes, Barney and Friends. It had been popular as a VHS.
Like, no friends were involved.
Yeah. But this is its big move to the public broadcasting system where it got even bigger, like huge, huge, huge.
There were tapes before this. It was sort of like Barney Begins, but it was with Sandy Duncan, correct?
That's right.
She was the superstar.
The big name. Yeah. No, I got just a little bit of that. Obviously, I was too old. By 1990, I was 8. I was not watching Barney for myself, but... my little brother was 5, so he actually did rent a couple Barney VHSs prior to the PBS debut, so I was aware of Barney. And, you know, the perfect timing for Barney that the entire internet early on would be about destroying him and laying waste to Barney.
I can remember one of the few bonding moments I had with my sister. We don't get along at all. One of the few moments we had was together making fun of the bad child acting on Barney. And we were also children. But we could identify how piss poor that acting was.
I remember, yeah, 92, I would have been 9. And Barney was like an insult in the playground. It's like, you watch Barney, motherfucker. Like, there was like a Barney witch hunt in like the 5th grade or whatever of like trying to find out who was actually into that shit. And the answer was nobody because we were all too old for it. But it's like, you're a baby because you listen to Barney or watch Barney.
You're not watching X-Men animated,
exactly.
Which is the cool thing.
We need to ask why these kids were hanging out after school unsupervised. I choose to believe it's a post-apocalyptic story in which the adults were all killed.
Sounds right.
And they're just together in a schoolhouse imagining a dinosaur.
It's
That's my dark, fucked up Barney reboot.
We need one. I forgot. What's his face is doing the one, isn't he? From Get Out.
Peacock is getting a Barney gritty thing, isn't
yes.
it?
Yes.
Well, there was a recent documentary about the Barney hate.
Oh, really?
You know? Right. Yeah, that was on Peacock. It seemed like it was formatted like a true crime doc. I was like, come on, guys.
No, get this. It was called I Love You, You Hate Me.
Oh,
how clever.
Yeah.
How clever.
Daniel Kaluuya is doing a dark reboot of Barney, apparently. Well, you know, take that with a grain of salt.
Wow. And well, and Steven, you lived in the Tri-County area, so it was bigger news there. But John Gotti and his downfall happened around this time.
That's exciting. Yeah, I was in the Bronx. I didn't feel any ripples in an Italian neighborhood in the Bronx.
Didn't hit your family.
No, we all skated by on that one. The Gotti stuff was always so, like, that was always very adult. Like, that for whatever reason, was something that was kept from me as a kid. You know what I mean? Like, very unaware of it until, like, kind of understanding it, like when Seinfeld kind of talked about it, and that, you know what I mean? Like, I got it through pop culture more than anything else.
Of course, the subject of one of the worst movies of this decade, I'd say.
Oh, man. E made the Gotti movie, folks.
The five boroughs, they make a fist.
I heard that critics were too stupid to get it.
That's usually how that works.
That was part of the marketing, I think.
Don't let the critics tell you what to watch.
They've been pushing you around your entire life, these critics. I can feel the ghostly hand of Ebert around my neck.
But anyway, that's all that happened when this episode aired.
Joining us today once again is Steven Sajdak of We Hate Movies. Welcome back to the show, Steven.
Thank you, guys. This is always a blast. I was really excited when you offered this to me. Like, I've been doing a lot of season three watching anyway, and I've never talked about Sideshow Bob on your show, so it's exciting to kind of dig into all that Kelsey Grammer stuff. And I watched a handful of Sideshow Bobs before just to kind of have it in my brain, and they are standouts, you know what I mean? They do kind of rise above. It's a special kind of a thing. At least in the earlier seasons, they didn't overuse him. It was either once a year or even once every other year kind of a deal.
Yeah, it was like a once every 18 months kind of thing,
yes.
Really. There's something special about the first sequel episode because it makes it a recurring series.
Yes.
Like, they could have chosen that Sideshow Bob would have never returned, like, basically the babysitter bandit. I mean, yes, there's one-off jokes every now and then, but she didn't really return. Or like Jock, who actually did just return in season 34.
Yes.
Sideshow Bob could have been just as forgotten, but it really is just Kelsey Grammer is perfection as Sideshow Bob. It seems like, you know, is he the best guy? No, I know. But man, is he good as Sideshow Bob.
I want to point out one thing, though, up front. The Wikipedia entry for this episode says, originally titled The Return of Sideshow Bob. There's no citation, so I looked that up, and it's buried in some old SNPP episode capsule. The SNPP was the old Simpsons website that would make these very elaborate episode capsules taken from things written in newsgroups. Within that capsule, buried in it, is someone saying, oh, it should have been called this.
Oh.
So, yes.
Boo.
That's not what it was originally called. I'm sorry. I just want to point that out. Change the Wikipedia entry. I'm furious.
This is an episode where it's very easy to catalog this kind of stuff because it is a rare one where the entire storyboards, noted storyboards by Matt Groening, are on the DVD, one of the very rare ones. Though I wish they'd re-release it scanned once more in HD, because sometimes text is very hard to read even on a big television for lines of dialogue. A couple times I was like, wait, what's this old line of dialogue that they changed for broadcast? But I have a few of them I still noted. But yeah, the storyboard is dated October 21st, 1991.
Okay.
So that's when they were working on it. The behind the scenes of why they did it, it was a thirst for awards, wasn't it?
Yes, they wanted to win an Edgar Award, not an Emmy, although I assume they would want to have won an Emmy too. But in this case, they were seeking an Edgar Award. So they hired a guy named Thomas Chastain to help them craft this mystery. So Thomas Chastain is a mystery writer and a novelist, and he was president of the Mystery Writers of America organization in 1989. He was not the current president, so they didn't have that much of an in, but they still had an in. And I'll point this out. He died in 1994. He was born in 1921, so he was 70 when he was helping this rude cartoon craft their sexy mystery.
Sam Simon wanted it so bad, too. He really did.
Yeah, I think that this, like, the whole, what do you call it, the gas fire and the woman that can't smell, like, that's all him. And, or maybe he had a good MacGyver one-liner, possibly, this very old man that came up with some of that as well.
Yeah, I would assume he put together the skeleton of, here's how the murder would happen, here's how to set it up with the clues. You guys fill in the jokes around that. They mentioned on the commentary, Mike Reese saying, like, look, there's a few lines that are just not jokes, that they have to just be a delivery of a clue.
And this guy, Chastain, he wrote over a dozen books, and I love mystery books. I love reading them. They're my favorite genre at this point. And I wanted to read one of his for this episode, because they're normally not that long, but they are incredibly out of print. not available digitally. And I went to our library system. Not one is in like the six libraries in our city.
Wow.
So,
oh man.
Yeah.
That's so sad. He's out of print. That's such a sad thing. If you die, that's one thing, that your stuff is unavailable and no one can even read it. Like, damn, that's sad.
Yeah. If he needed a movie adaptation, apparently, you know what I mean? Like, that's how anybody stays in print, especially I think the mystery genre, unless you're just some middle tier, you will just disappear, which is very kind of Ozymandias in the sands and in the desert kind of a thing.
Yeah, Agatha Christie, every book she wrote, always in print. This guy, not the case. I looked up his most famous novel, and apparently it was 1983's Who Killed the Robbins Family, and this was a mystery novel that was also a contest. So you're supposed to read this novel and then answer 40 questions in the back and send them in. And if you could answer all 40, you would win $10,000. Apparently, four people answered 39 out of 40 correctly, and they won the money. So there you have it.
That's 40 questions.
That bit was mentioned in his obituary, but not that it was 40 questions. The obituary made it sound like, all right, who killed him? But man, though, that feels like cheating that your bestseller has a gimmick like that, that like it's a contest.
Also, the 40th question was a math one. Like everything else was context clues for the mystery itself. Who did this? Where did it take place? And the 40th one is just like, if X equals Z, what, you know.
Yeah. What's the solve for X crap?
So here's a funny bit added to it from the last time we covered this, which is in Mike Reese's book, he had an extra bit of trivia about the Edgar Awards. He mentions again what they say in the commentary. Sam Simon really wanted to win it, and he didn't. This book was written posthumously, and he's still mentioning, like, I'm sorry for Simon, he didn't get to win that thing. But he says, but I did in 2000 for my caveman detective story, Cro-Magnon P.I. The award is a painted plaster bust of Edgar Allan Poe and looks like a novelty bottle that should be filled with bourbon, as the real Poe often was. Ba-dum-tsh. That's a good one. So he did win an award, and Cro-Magnon P.I. is a fun detective story that's also like out of print. It was just published in a magazine. It maybe got collected somewhere, but the award, it's not just any old Edgar. It is the Robert L. Fish Memorial Award, which is the distinction of someone's first published short story of a mystery style. So he won it. It's a win. Yeah. But, you know, I don't know. A 45-year-old already published writer going like, well, this is my first mystery, though.
It's a participation trophy, you're thinking?
Maybe. So it's funny to know that Mike Reese, he won it 9 years after they wrote this.
Apparently, it was published in an issue of Alfred Hitchcock's Mystery Magazine, a magazine that is still running. There are two currently running mystery magazines. I found this out recently. Wow. Alfred Hitchcock's and Ellery Queen's, both named after long dead people. But they come out every like other month, and they're full of mystery stories, both new and old. There's still a market until all the 80-year-olds today are dead.
And it's print, I assume.
It's print, yeah. That's, I think there's digital versions too, but these are always like buried in the back of newsstands behind like the puzzle books and stuff. They're always there.
Yeah, that's good airplane fodder and or a hospice fodder as well would be nice.
You know, I was looking up some of the things that did get nominated in 92 and 93 of like, all right, well, what did Simpsons not even get nominated against? And back then it was mostly shows from the UK of like Sherlock and Poirot stuff.
Okay.
A few years later, it would be like Law and Order SVU won a few, but I don't think the funny cartoon show Simpsons even had a chance. And really, I bet there was an episode of Scooby-Doo that was better as a mystery this season.
I like the idea that SVU would win because those mysteries are so poor in general. It's like, oh, here's something in the beginning of the episode. It's almost like a Simpsons gag where like it almost has nothing to do with anything else. And the first person that you arrest is absolutely not it, no matter where their DNA is, what state of undress they're in. They didn't rape nobody.
Yeah, in every SVU episode, at the 28-minute mark, one of the prosecutors says, look, this guy's a son of a bitch, but he didn't do it. He's got an airtight alibi.
John Vitti, the writer for this episode, I think he said that it's sort of written like a Columbo in that not a whodunit, but how he did it kind of mystery, where you obviously Sideshow Bob is the murderer. I'm sure the commercial set it up as that, but it's more like, well, how did the mechanics of this potential murder work?
Especially in the third act when you see Bob waiting for the explosion, like that just is a scene from Columbo.
Yep.
Like that is framed in film like it, though if they've been just slightly more ambitious. And this is a great, great, great episode too. But MacGyver is central to the plot of it, then it should be a parody of a MacGyver style plot instead of a Columbo style plot.
That's right.
Stylistically, it would fit a little better.
it is funny that Sajdak Bob decries the hack writing and all that stuff of MacGyver. Not that this is hack writing, but it's very TV, right? You know what I mean? He's this clownish villain walking in off the street. Everybody knows he's going to do it, and then he does it.
And it's a special guest star, so the most famous person's the guilty one, because it's the special guest star.
Speaking of guest stars, I want to point this out before we truly get into things. I think this is Steve's fifth appearance on Talking Simpsons.
Whoa!
Oh, man, the five-timers club. Yeah. You're right.
Yes?
Oh, go ahead. No. We have a jacket for you. Yes. You need to pay for shipping and production of the jacket.
Okay, good. And a little something for you guys, too. Yeah, okay, yes. I got it.
It takes time to go on that website.
I'm in Who's Who now, where I'm just giving money to a crooked corporation so my name's in a book. Understood.
Exactly. We've got a Who's Who among Talking Simpsons guests, and we'll put you on Mount Rushmore for the year.
All right.
I think you are one of the very few that has passed five guest appearances, I believe.
Well, thank you. I love coming on here. I love Talking Simpsons, right?
That's a two-part, yeah. That's a good. I'm going to clip that out.
We're going to make an ad out of that, too.
There's some other funny behind-the-scenes stuff, not just the storyboards that are on the DVD, but also Silverman has shared a lot. Like, he's very proud of this episode. He updated the Sideshow Bob design quite a lot for it, because Brad Bird, if you watch season one, you'll see Sideshow Bob's first appearance. Well, he looks very little like Sideshow Bob, especially his hair isn't his hair. And basically, through working on Krusty Gets Busted, they're changing Sideshow Bob like almost every act. Like, he is slowly shifting. And so now that he's coming back, Silverman formalized the design of Sideshow Bob into the true Sideshow Bob that we'll see from this point onward in the series. On the DVD, he's got a great instruction manual, like, here's how his head needs to be framed. Yes, it does look like a palm tree. Think of it like that. It's really cool. And there's a lot of great special notes in there. Also, Bob was one of the first people to make me aware of this, and you can see it in the extras on the storyboards. Matt Groening is very upfront about, like, that he is PC Matt on this, and that he is the guy who is trying to tell them, like, hey, be careful with this. Remember to keep the Simpsons universe fully integrated. Asians, blacks, Latinos, etc. Like, I think he was getting some notes back then at the time of, come on, man, who cares, you know? Who cares about all this diversity stuff?
Well, I believe on the storyboards you're talking about, Henry, he writes that Richard Sakai was not happy with some of the Asian caricatures in the sushi episode. So I think that feedback helped as well.
Yeah. I mean, it helped that out of the rather undiverse for its time production on the show, they actually did have one of the top producers on the show is a Japanese-American man who could say, like, hey, you went a bit broad with these karaoke people.
Let's relax is kind of a fair one after the sushi episode.
Some producers call Japanese people karaoke people.
Karaoke. Karaoke attendees. Also, I haven't done a Tales of the Tape in a while, but I will do a quick one here.
Ooh, we're back.
Sometimes I have weird memories about this one because we taped them off TV and I watched them in reruns all the time. I just replay it, and that is the Simpsons that exist in my mind. But in cases like this one, my family was out of town that week and we missed taping it, and I didn't tape this one until syndication. So it is a rare one where the syndication version is the one in my mind, and every time there's a scene that wasn't in syndication, messes with my head. And I think it was because my family was in the middle of moving from Atlanta to Jacksonville.
Priorities, Henry. Priorities.
When we finally get to, I believe a couple months later, I convinced them to get a VCR that can be set to record while we're gone. And one of my happiest memories, we'll say it again in the Beauty Queen episode, but we had moved in the week of the Lisa Beauty Queen episode, and I was adamant of, like, I don't care that we only have lawn chairs or whatever, like, and I am 9 saying this, and, like, we have to set up the TV and the VCR right now to watch this episode. Like, we have to.
Or you're going to hear about it. I used to have a really shitty MP3 player that would warble certain songs, and when I rehear the songs now, I know where the warble should be, and the fact that there isn't one freaks me out a little bit.
That's how, also, I've mentioned a lot of times my hubris of taping off TV was hitting the pause button on commercials and thinking, like, I can unpause it just at the right time, and missing, like, the first 5 seconds of so many classic Simpsons scenes.
I had a memory about being weird about TV, and very brief in that there was a new Mystery Science Theater, and I think company was over, and I was rarely obligated to hang out with company, but this time I was for some reason. But I had to tell my mom, like, listen, it's a new Mystery Science Theater. I have to be there to watch it. And she made a big deal out of it in front of company. Like, Bobby's got to watch his TV show, God. So say goodbye to him. And I was like, that's right.
I will take humiliation for Mystery Science Theater for sure.
Absolutely. It was a good trade.
That's right up there with families visiting for Thanksgiving, and you have to say, like, this game can't be saved, Mom. It's not that type of game. It's going to just have to wait, all right? Well, all right. Well, this episode begins with a real mean shot at another television show.
It certainly does. Do you think it was hard for them to write this show inside of their glass house, Henry?
I know, right? No, what are you talking about? The Simpsons invented family sitcoms. Like, I'll play the clip first, and then I have some thoughts.
Would you turn off that rock and rock music?
Hey, you don't have a stegosaurus, man.
These talking dinosaurs are more real than most real families on TV.
Look, Maggie, they have a baby, too.
It's like they saw our lives and put it right up on screen.
They really didn't like dinosaurs.
I remember watching this as a kid and being defensive of dinosaurs even then. Being like, excuse you, there's room enough for both. Dinosaurs bound to be a classic show, just like you, The Simpsons. You both exist on the same level. And then, obviously, life found a way to destroy those dinosaurs.
I think this was based on one of the producers, maybe Mike Reese, just seeing it on TV and thinking, like, what is this crap? And not realizing that it is a very brilliant satire that obviously could never have been on TV without The Simpsons. Even though Jim Henson was developing it before The Simpsons TV show was on Fox, I think The Simpsons allowed weirder stuff to be on TV. But Mike Reese says on the commentary, like, oh, nobody remembers this show, but now it's like all of it's on Disney Plus for all of us to enjoy.
Right next to The Simpsons.
Yeah.
In the Funny Families tab, actually, today. When I turned on Disney Plus, you know, they have the suggested playlists and stuff on the front page, and one of them was Funny Families, and darn it, The Simpsons were first. They are the funniest family.
And the baby, I think, obviously really separates it from The Simpsons, because that baby is talking, he's got a catchphrase, and the whole thing.
Yeah, baby Sinclair, very different from Maggie, honestly. Yeah. Yeah, I don't want to guess that it was Mike Reese in particular who was mad about it. And again, we've had Mike Reese as a guest on our show. He's a very nice guy, very funny. But he's the guy who did say that he felt King of the Hill was just Homer with glasses on it. And I was like, no, it's not. Yeah. I'm sorry. And I think he's defensive in that same way. But yeah, like, experiencing it as a child, definitely when Dinosaurs first debuted in late April 1991, it was like, oh, this is the new Bart Mania. In 1990, you felt Bart Mania. Now it's Dinosaurs time, and it's what you're supposed to be excited about. And of course, I loved Dinosaurs. Like, its biggest problem was the first season's 5 damn episodes, and then you're waiting like almost a year for more. Like,
expensive show. Not to go on too long, but this was a show I watched with my family, like The Simpsons, and they were huge Muppet fans from the 70s. So they're like, oh, this is the new Jim Henson thing, and it's very funny. And I've said this before on a podcast, but my parents laughed a little too much at the marijuana episode, I'll tell you that.
Yeah, the Dinosaurs' previous guest of the show, Jose, on his channel on YouTube, did a great Dinosaurs retrospective about how in your memories you just see I'm the baby, gotta love me, bonk with the frying pan.
Not the mama, etc.
But it actually is full of clever satire, including like some gutsier satire than even Simpsons was doing. At the same time, right after Desert Storm, they are doing a two-parter about how Desert Storm is just a political circus to distract from the things politicians should be fixing. It's really good. But yeah, like you said, Bob, I think it was a combo of it was something Jim Henson had been working on. He dies in May 1990. At the same time, The Simpsons gets huge. And that's when ABC is especially like, oh, you know what? That Henson idea. It's a funny family.
Yeah. But if you're in your 30s or 40s and a creator, you grew up watching The Flintstones. And obviously, you can take that apple both ways. You can make it a funny cartoon family that's takes place now, or what if there were dinosaurs doing what the Flintstones were doing, and we could integrate all these cool puppet stuff that we can do and really make this a real flesh and blood world.
And honestly, it owes way more to All in the Family than it does to The Simpsons, because
down to Sally Struthers being the daughter.
Exactly. Yes. And also, it's in a locked set. Like, I mean, they do go some other places, but because it's not a cartoon like Simpsons, they often do have to play out like a staged set kind of play of just like five characters here, and they're just going to talk through, you know, parables of creationism or sexism in the workplace or the end of the world in its memorable finale.
So we're saying look forward to talking dinosaurs when we run out of ideas.
There should be a What a Cartoon About Dinosaurs next year.
Next year.
Yeah, maybe. So yeah, anyway, I, as a kid, felt this was like, why are they so mean to dinosaurs? Yeah. That show's good. The album did also come out around the same time as this. It's called Big Songs. I forgot that. That has the, I'm the baby, gotta love me. Don't you wish there were more of me?
Wow. Just landfill fodder, man. Just ready, just immediately ready to go into the landfill.
There's an artificial reef somewhere of dinosaur CDs.
And you could say like, oh, they're ripping off how the Simpsons did Sing the Blues. And it's like, you do not need to tell the Henson Company how to merchandise something. They didn't rip that off from The Simpsons.
Cashing in is cashing in all the time.
I also like that they just had Nancy for the teen boy dinosaur. Just do Bart's voice. Yes. Don't do anything else with it. And they also animate it like their puppet mouths that just flap open and closed. They're being
cruel to the puppets, too. This is a full-on Dinosaurs Defense podcast now, by the way. Where Mike Reese on the commentary is like, they had some foam rubber puppets. Those are the most sophisticated puppets man had invented at that point in time.
Later on in the Troy McClure episode, or the earliest time to talk about the Muppets, is pretty derisive-ish as well. They didn't really appreciate what Henson was doing. And I guess trying to animate a puppet, the only way you could do it is like, it looks like real but shitty. You know what I mean? I guess it's kind of difficult unless you're doing like puppet lines.
In 1996, it was decided like, well, no child knows what the Muppets are. They're trash.
Mm-hmm.
Clearly, this is a show with three defensive Muppet fans. Then all that ends and Patty arrives wearing her usual party outfit of funeral black, which I love that. She says there's a shocking secret about Selma's new boyfriend. And just like in Homer at the Bat in Separate Vocations, it is a trio of thought balloons.
I forgot this was a runner, right?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Obviously, they would have cutaways and stuff for a ton after this, but to have three people have thought bubble appear and they think of it, this is the third of that trio of running gags, yeah.
The Simpsons family, we love a John Merrick joke. If we can find it, if we can find a way to do it, we're going to do it. And that's why I make John Merrick jokes to this day.
Lisa has seen the Elephant Man. Homer has seen the brain that wouldn't die.
Here's the back to MST3K. They're referencing this before Mystery Science Theater does that episode because they're similarly aged nerds.
Good old Jan in the Pan.
Jan in the Pan. Also, in the notes on the dream sequence, Groening honestly thinks it's not very funny, or he's like, is this the best? And his big note was, though, on Elephant Man, make it very clear that this is an Elephant Man movie joke and not a quote-unquote handicapped a joke. It's like he wanted to be very clear on that.
You got to do the potato sack. You need to do full-on potato sack to do that. And it reminds me so much of the critic joke, which I love the most, which is, what a loser.
Yes.
He's got some babes in his Ferrari, right?
Best thing that I've ever seen.
Him laughing while snuffling at the same time. So yeah, at first Bart is excited to hear it's an ex-con. I also love that Selma frames it as this crazy obsession of not dying alone. They then learn that it's not just any old ex-con. And we get another first here.
That's them. Now, remember, everyone, be understanding and forgiving for the sake of family unity.
Everyone, I'd like you to meet.
Sideshow Bob!
What the?
Selma, dear, I'm afraid the children's reaction is quite understandable. You see, Bart here is the Seamus in short pants who sent me to prison.
That's right, Aunt Selma. Your new boyfriend here framed Krusty the Clown for armed robbery.
Gee, if some snot-nosed little kid sent me to prison, the first thing out, I'd find out where he lives and tear him a new belly button. Lousy snitch.
Ah, Mr. Simpson. You're forgetting the first two noble truths of the Buddha.
I am not.
Yes, you are. One, existence is suffering. Two, the cause of suffering is desire. In this case, my desire to do high-quality children's programming. When prison put an end to that dream, I became a seething cauldron of rage and recrimination.
Ah, man, his voice, a wonderful voice. And that
is the second time in 3 hours that no, I am not got me. It's the speed of the rejoinder is so perfect.
That was the first ever, Sideshow Bob there. Though this episode is where the divide happens because is definitely Lisa and Bart that take down Bob in the first one, though it's Bart who gets the final blow on him in it. But in this one, Lisa doesn't do nothing. It's all Bart.
It's
this
all
is
Bart.
Not co-op. Yeah.
And I don't want to be tedious, but this episode is very well directed. I'm not going to call it everything, but there are so many just very good shots. David Silverman is a master at directing The Simpsons. And one of the things I love is like the Ah Sideshow Bob is from Bob's perspective looking down at the children. It's so great. And there's more great stuff to come. I only, you know, noted a few really standout shots to not go overboard on this.
Homer's knife is so serrated. It's weird to see a serrated knife on The Simpsons because you'd want to round it out like you would round out most things, but to put the serration makes that joke much more visceral and gritty of the tear him a new belly button.
And just framed in front of Bart's face. He's watching the knife dance around.
All the ways Homer would carve him to pieces.
Yeah. And Bob in this part of his life is not defined by hatred of Bart, although there's a little bit of that in this. When he becomes Max Cady from Dape Fear, that redefines his character for the rest of the series. But still, he's willing to kill Bart, but that's not his obsession yet.
That's how you build story and build improv. And that's what I love about how Sideshow Bob develops. Like the first time, he hates Krusty the Clown. The second time, I kind of want vengeance on the Simpsons, but I have this nefarious plot. Third, I am obsessed with killing Bart. And then from then on out, it goes back and forth, all of those things. And I think we got our first ee-hoo-ee-hoo-ness with the massage. And all these things just kind of stick to this character. I mean, he is kind of iconic, right? The design, the voice. Did he make it into any video games? I'm asking the right people here.
Well, he's definitely in the Simpsons game. He is a boss. I think it's like the museum level. Not the full boss of the entire game, but
I have to ask you because I've never gotten anywhere in that game. I'm fucking terrible at it.
Do you mean the Simpsons game? The late aughts one?
Yeah, that's the one. Yeah. I remember him in that. And I'm sure he's like a boss in one of the Bart games.
Yeah.
I'm going to say Bart's Nightmare or Space Mutants. I think he might be.
They worked him into all those old games because there were no other Bart villains except for the Babysitter Bandit. And yeah, she was there too in those old games.
And it was so awesome that he was the villain of the ride too, because he's not in the movie, but it almost feels like, and they were produced pretty much concurrently, that almost feels like they were decided no Sideshow Bob in the movie because he is all the ride, and the ride is almost as big as the movie to the Simpsons company.
The Simpsons will be right back.
The Simpsons are making plans for a perfect wedding.
Well, Homer, what should we serve?
You can't go wrong with cocktail weenies.
The Simpsons, tonight on Fox.
Welcome to the break, everybody. Whether you're enjoying a cocktail weenie or not, I am your co-host, Henry Gilbert, and a big thank you to our guest this week, Steven Sajdak, for coming on and chatting about Black Widow with us. We are such big fans of We Hate Movies. We can't wait to see them when they're touring the West Coast. Look up their tour date on the We Hate Movies page. Check out all the cool stuff they're doing on Patreon, Steven. It's so awesome to have you back again, and we can't wait to have you back another time. And also, if you enjoy talking Simpsons, you should know this podcast is only possible thanks to the support of patrons like you, who go to patreon.com/talkingsimpsons to subscribe. $5 a month is all it takes for me and Bob to do this as our full-time real jobs from people like you. Plus, that $5 gets you with over 150 exclusive podcasts on the Patreon, including two new ones each month where we cover Futurama and King of the Hill, one episode at a time. We're deep into seasons 4 and 3, respectively, for those shows, plus the back catalog of us covering everything from The Critic, Mission Hill, and Batman the Animated Series. And there's tons more there. Check it out for yourself at patreon.com/talkingsimpsons. But if you're a real trencherman, then you need to head over to the premium level at patreon.com/talkingsimpsons because subscribers there not only get all the $5 things I just mentioned, but for $10 a month, they get our monthly What a Cartoon Movie podcast. Me and Bob going super in-depth into an animated feature film, just like we do with The Simpsons, meaning we often talk for over 5, even 6 hours about these movies. This month, we are doing our April Fools of live action on the Patreon, and that means we're covering Little Shop of Horrors, a true beloved 80s classic of me and Bob. We cannot wait to talk about it. The previous month, we covered the DreamWorks 2000 film Chicken Run. That was so much fun to talk about, that Aardman original. And there's a giant back catalog of us covering everything from Akira to A Goofy Movie, Spider-Man Into the Spider-Verse to Beavis and Butthead Do the Universe, so many Disney classics as well, a ton of anime too. You need to check it out for yourself. The entire back catalog, including our longest podcast ever, 6.5 hours about Who Framed Roger Rabbit. Please see it all for yourself one more time. That's patreon.com/talkingsimpsons. His explosion of hair when he takes off his hat, like, that's such an amazing shot, too. And yeah, speaking of perspective, Bob, there's so many great scenes where you know that Bart's supposed to be listening to a clue that will come up later, and it's usually framed from Bart's level, like the camera is down at Bart's level. Every time I compliment old Simpsons, I feel like I have to, like, be negative about current Simpsons, but I don't feel like they play with perspective as often. No. On the last decade or so of Simpsons.
Yeah, there's like an honest to goodness Dutch angle at the end of this episode, and I'm like, wow, the Simpsons were doing it. It's about cheating that stuff to give the emotion and what you want from your characters, which a Dutch angle is like, shit is going crazy right now.
Kelsey Grammer's back. All of this jail stuff. I realize now, all of this jail stuff with him is them kind of dunking on the bad boy persona of Kelsey Grammer at the time.
Yeah, there's a funny story in the commentary where Mike Reese is directing Kelsey Grammer. It's a scene where his Emmy is being taken away, and Mike Reese tells Kelsey, okay, Kelsey, I want you to sound like you're being beaten up by guards. And he goes, oh, I know what that sounds like. because he did spend 14 days in jail for violating probation.
Which may as well be 8 years to a celebrity.
Yeah. Like, he got the celebrity slap on the wrist of like, okay, we'll give you probation. And then he screwed that up. So he actually had to go to jail.
So many drunk driving or cocaine possession things. Yeah, it's...
And that we have the Republican bit. Obviously, we have to put that in there very early on. You can imagine how difficult it is to be in prison as a lifelong Republican. LOL.
Yeah, that thing flew over my head as a child, of course. Yes. And then by the time it became a plot point in Sideshow Bob Roberts, I was at least old enough to go like, yeah, Republicans suck, right? and they do. I didn't realize it wasn't just out of nowhere that Sideshow Bob would be a Republican politician. And you could definitely see a world where Kelsey Grammer thought he'd end up like Ronald Reagan too.
Yep.
But he just had to, at least for the 90s, too many arrests for to run for Congress.
With Kelsey Grammer, I understand. Now, this is pretty dark, but if you look into his past, you can kind of see where the substance abuse came from, because when he was young, his father and his sister were both murdered in separate incidents. So he comes from a very dark past.
Yeah,
so
yeah.
I understand how that can make you into a Republican who does drugs.
Sure. Yeah. Yeah. Though right now, the 68-year-old is on a real career boost. No longer is he just the star of The Money Plane, but he's the star of the Christian movie nobody watched but is extremely popular, Jesus Revolution.
He also did a Lifetime movie, which I can't believe I didn't watch last year. It was around Christmas. My wife and I always do a shit ton of Lifetime and Hallmark movies. And it was one where I think Kelsey Grammer died 12 days of Christmas. Like, he dies. It's like a Groundhog Day joke where he has to get it right. And at the end of each one, he dies, I think. Like, in the trailer, it's just like him like falling off a building or something. I'll have to look it up. I'll pull it up for you folks.
You know, I'll watch that one with my mom next holiday season. That sounds like good mom watching.
And we were just talking about Picard season 3 before the episode started. And it's funny how that is a big like, hey, the gang's all here. We're all together again with the Frasier reboot. It's just like, well, nobody really wanted to work with Kelsey Grammer again, and it's just him, and maybe he has new friends. Who knows?
I was looking at the cast. Yeah, B.B. Newirth has said she'll come on for a guest appearance, but that's it. Nobody else. None of the regulars you loved Frasier for. Like, look, we do love Kelsey Grammer and Frasier, but how do you do it without David Hyde Pierce?
You can. I mean, especially since John Mahoney's dead. Like, if John Mahoney is dead, which is unfortunate, he's not coming back for it. That's already Frasier in name only, but now if we're doing David Hyde Pierce, like, that's nothing. And by the way, the movie I'm talking about is the 12 Days of Christmas Eve. Brian Conway, a successful businessman, gets into a car accident on Christmas Eve. Santa gives him 12 chances to redo the day and repair the relationship to find the true meaning of Christmas. I need to watch this movie.
Well, you know, this Frasier thing has been delayed for so long that they can just deepfake Eddie at this point. There's one more returning cast member.
You know, Eddie's owners can give away his life rights now, like to the digital Eddie, and then can be an NFT as well. No, it's, but yes, having him be an ex-con and also a Republican, that is so on the nose of like, he's just Kelsey Grammer.
An Emmy winner who goes to prison, right?
Yes. Yeah. Also that. Yeah. Yes. He'd already been a multi-time Emmy winner, I believe, at this point. At least one for Cheers. they couldn't even imagine the kind of success he'd have after this, which the troubles he had during the making of Cheers, you'd be like, well, there's no way he will have a 9-season-long, incredibly yes. successful spinoff. No way. And yet,
it just shows to the guy. I mean, like, you know, again, Republicans are not crazy about it. All the other stuff in the Kelsey Grammer arsenal. He's so fucking talented. You know what I mean? Like, this voice is so perfect, especially it really starts to kick up in this episode. And obviously, Cape Fear goes really, really over the top.
They keep complimenting him on the commentary of like, this was a crazy line and he did it good the first time. Like, yep. Take one, just perfection. John Vitti mentions too on the commentary, this was a tough one to write because Sideshow Bob is at his most fun when he is evil, but he has to pretend to be good for two acts of the episode. Yeah. So you have to tamp him down. So you can see why in Cape Fear, they're like, fuck that. We're just going to have fun. Like, he's crazy evil the entire episode. We're going to really indulge. Also, this episode is kind of a sequel, at least this act, to Like Father, Like Clown. Bob over for dinner is laid out just like when yeah. Krusty goes to dinner in
it's
that episode.
It's a big act one flashback.
Yeah, yeah. And also, yes, the Four Noble Truths of the Buddha are the truth of suffering, the truth of the cause of suffering, the truth of the end of suffering, and the truth of the path that leads to the end of suffering. Those are the Four Noble Truths.
Just talking about direction, and I think the lighting, I guess more so the coloring, of showing that this is evening. You feel we're over the Simpsons for dinner for the evening, and later on, everything is the same, not monochromatic, but just bright, bright, bright all the time. It doesn't matter what time of day it is. You know what the Simpsons dining room looks like. It could be breakfast, lunch, or dinner.
And so many in animation scene transitions too. Sometimes scene transitions just happen in editing, or that's normally it. Like, they just, well, they animate this scene, now it's the next scene. But if you decide in animation, this is how a scene's going to transition, it takes an extra level of care that you can't just edit it away. And the way it goes, him saying like a recrimination, and then it goes into the pile of garbage he's cleaning up. That is yep. such a great shot. Pretty much shot for shot from Cool Hand Luke in the garbage picking up scene from that.
I finally saw that last year. And guess what, folks? It's a good movie. Check it out.
I still haven't seen it. I've only seen the references.
I actually want to rewatch that now, watching this episode. I've been kind of sort of like bouncing around Paul Newman's career, which is a fun thing to do. Color of Money is fantastic. I rewatched the Tom Hanks movie, his last movie, which is, oh God.
Oh, Road to Perdition.
Road to Perdition. I hadn't seen it forever.
That's a great one.
Yeah, it's a yeah. great one. Yeah.
I like him in Police Squad and Naked Gun stuff, but a surprisingly good role from George Kennedy.
Yes.
Who you're normally used to seeing like old and bloated. Here he's kind of like a very sunburned hunk. In
oh,
this movie.
Man. Wow. Mm-hmm. A hunky George Kennedy. Yeah. Sound of
I mean, it's a sexy movie, dude. Full on. Let's go. Let's watch it.
We head to the Daytime Emmy Awards.
When I was nominated for Best Supporting Performer in a Children's Program at the Daytime Emmy Awards, my bitterness ruined what should have been the greatest night of my life.
And the nominees are Droopy Drawers, Colonel Coward, Pepito, the biggest cat in the whole wide world, Sideshow Bob, and Suck Up the Vacuum. And the Emmy goes to... Oh, I don't believe this. Sideshow Bob.
This is one more Emmy than you'll ever win, you bantering jack-in-the-box.
Just don't drop that thing in the shower, Bob.
No talent, shill.
Second banana.
Panderer.
Boar.
Stop it. I can't. Release me.
Now for the highlight of the evening, best film to video transfer.
Do you know what prison is like for a lifelong conservative Republican? In our overcrowded cell, we became little more than beasts. Who used my chapstick?
Oh, I did. Here you go.
I don't want it.
I feel like there's a little condescension towards the Daytime Emmy Awards dripping off of this here. That it's like best supporting sidekick in an award. Like, they make up that for the Daytime Emmys.
They were being nominated with kids shows a lot of the time. And I mean, a lot of them were quality kids shows, but they probably wanted to be like up against sitcoms, you know?
Yeah. Though they were still on the Primetime Emmys, though.
Yeah.
It was against, as well, they will be pissed off by 3 months after this airs. They lose to the Claymation Easter radio part, which led to a lot of negativity from The Simpsons. I had forgotten. I have the clip right here. August of 1991, right before they wrote this episode, Bart Simpson actually introduces the Primetime Emmy Awards that year.
Oh, wow.
I have a little clip of it here.
Live
live from the Pasadena Civic Auditorium, it's the Bart Simpson Show, starring Bart Simpson, featuring the 43rd Annual Emmy Award, with Ronnie Anderson, Christina Applegate, Beatrice Arthur.
Okay.
Is it Bart animated or is it Bart in a costume?
It is Bart animated, okay. Yeah. If I had to guess, it looks very rough drafty and good. It's just Bart in a tuxedo.
By rough draft, you mean the studio?
Yes, sorry. The Korean studio, rough draft. It's Bart in a tuxedo. It's like Space Ghost Coast to Coast. Like they had 20 frames of animation of him talking and they just cycle through that. Yeah.
That sounds about right.
I want to know about this Suck Up the Vacuum movie that's being filmed in Spain.
I love it. It shows that, like, make me think that Suck Up the Vacuum is very popular in Spain and not as much in America.
I could have used a little more of Pepito, the biggest cat in the whole wide world. It's a great little joke. It's a great character design. He should be walking around with Bumblebee Man at least once.
Yeah, he should be Bumblebee Man's sidekick.
Yeah, I forgot about him.
That stable.
Recently on Twitter or maybe our Discord, I saw someone has a Pepito tattoo and it's great.
That's awesome.
You got to dig deep for your Simpsons tattoo these days, folks.
Him with his eyes over his hands crying. Like, though I also like that next to Droopy Drawers is like a beautiful woman. Yes. And when he loses, she kind of turns away from like, his date is very disappointed.
The drawers aren't drooping tonight, folks.
Bob wins the Emmy as presented to him by Krusty, telling Krusty it's one more Emmy than you'll ever win. Don't drop that thing in the shower, he says with graining. Love that joke. He wrote exclamation point brilliant.
It's funny because they cut the prison rape joke out of Krusty Gets Busted. I think Krusty had a line like, you know what they do to a new clown in prison?
Yeah,
or something like that.
Right. Yeah. But this one, graining liked it. Unless it was a sarcastic brilliant he wrote on there. Oh, also that they have an award for best film to video transfer.
Yes.
What a great line.
That could be a joke about the technical Emmys, too.
Now what we've all been waiting for, the award for best film to video transfer, which is fantastic.
Which is also about making it look worse. Going from film to video, it looks shitty. So we head to the overcrowded prison system. They said they were little more than animals passing around chapstick. Another grating note on the chapstick hander is, not a black guy, Graining said. Like, don't, please don't have this be a black guy who hands over the chapstick, which I think that was a good,
good instinct. But, yeah.
I mean, the cultural commentary now that Bob underlines later is that the prisons are crowded because of Republicans being in power.
Mm-hmm,
is that the commentary here?
I do think it's a little that, which, it's also funny because the prison system, as Sideshow Bob imagines it, would have kept Kelsey Grammer in jail for like 5 years for his crime.
In a supply closet.
Yeah.
And later on we get, you can't keep the Democrats out of the White House forever. I'll be back, which is kind of the other side of that joke.
And he does return when Bill Clinton's in office. But this is when we see that Bob is starting to go crazy. We see Sideshow Bob's a little bit of what we'll see of him in Cape Fear. He even has a Die Bart.
Yes.
We're not yet to Die Bart Die, but we're getting there. I love his line of like, but what kind of a guest would I have been? Everybody laughs but Bart.
Yeah, Lisa's looking bad in this episode, despite being a super sleuth and Krusty Gets Busted.
Yeah, it's true. She even thanks him for being a credit to the revolving door prison system, which... very dark. They take away Bob's Emmy. You're not allowed to have any awards there, not even a Golden Globe. That also went over my head then of like, Golden Globes suck. Like,
yes. Awards for artistic excellence all have to be contraband, which is a great way to put that. We get some Snake as well. That's exciting.
Yes, this is a real big episode for old Snake here. But first, Bob gets a pen pal.
Hi, Caramba!
Bart, if I wanted to kill you, I'd have choked you like a chicken as soon as I walked in that door. But then what kind of a guest would I have been? Now, where was I? Ah, yes, my lowest ebb.
You can't take my Emmy!
Hey, you know the rules. Awards for excellence in entertainment are contraband. No Emmys, no Oscars, not even a Golden Globe.
But Kismet can be kind as well as cruel. I received an answer to my letter from the Prison Pen Pal Program.
Dear number 24601, I need a man, and I cannot find one among the law-abiding. I have a steady job and a lucrative hobby filing nuisance lawsuits. I share an apartment with my twin sister. Enclosed is a photo of us on a tandem bike. I forget which one I am.
I love that picture of them on the tandem bike. It's a great drawing.
I mean, I love Julie Kavner all over this episode. She's doing all these voices. She's so fucking good. And I kind of put it together that like Patty and Selma is Julie Kavner doing a mean Julie Kavner impression, which is... is kind of what she's doing.
She's on the commentary, and I think Mike Reese asked her, does that hurt your voice to do that? And she goes, not at all. She's normally like very husky to begin with.
Yeah.
Al Jean also sets her up for like, oh, and you play the sisters different, right? Nope. And he was kind of like, oh, I thought you did. Like, it is the best commentary Julie Kavner's on. Sometimes she has little to add, but, and I'm not saying she has a ton to add on this one either, but she's a lot of fun on it. And she actually seems to really enjoy this episode too. She legit LOLs at the end of the episode watching it.
Mm-hmm.
24601, that is Jean Valjean's prisoner number in Les Miserables, at least in the musical. I haven't read the book. I just know that I've watched the musical 800 times. I actually have seen it 5 times live and on stage in my lifetime, and better every time.
Never had the pleasure. I actually just saw Sweeney Todd this weekend. It's pretty good.
Ooh. Oh, cool.
Sondheim is classier than Les Mis. Any Sondheim, I know. The lucrative hobby of nuisance lawsuits. That's an important, or it would have been an important line. I saw this on the storyboards. This was supposed to be why she's rich, that Bob is trying to kill her. This is supposed to be an early clue how he knows he wants to marry her to kill her. She says, lucrative hobby of nuisance lawsuits.
I mean, I love this episode. I think one of the flaws is they don't underline her supposed wealth enough. Yeah. It's just kind of one drop line somewhere in Act Two, and you kind of forget why Bob is doing this outside of revenge on the Simpsons family. But we need to see the piles of wealth or some indicator of the wealth. But again, a fantastic episode. I think that's just one little flaw in it.
It actually kind of makes some sense with how many vacations Patty and Selma take themselves on.
Yes.
You know, where are they getting this money on a DMV salary? And they haven't even been promoted yet. Because it's like, well, aren't they rich? They have a nice apartment. It kind of makes some sense that she would have some money squirreled away, but it's never, to your point, underlined.
I think it's that they wanted to have a funnier line of her saying she invested in Mace right before society crumpled.
Yes. Yeah.
But they didn't realize that they originally, at least in the storyboards, it's her saying, one of my lawsuits really came through and I have a bunch more money right now. Mm. And so nuisance lawsuits works as a clue early, but by taking away that line and changing it to the Mace line, it robs this scene of her being a person who files nuisance lawsuits is a very early 90s thing to complain about. People are using the law too much to extract things from companies. How dare they?
But they put an end to that.
I think they really got away with something. While Sideshow Bob is reading that letter, a man is sitting at waist level with another man's crotch, and the guy hands him the chapstick. Like, I don't know. I feel like it is meant to indicate a sexual act.
You know, I framed through it, and I thought they were indicating something at first. Like, the chapstick was a kind of visual metaphor for a penis. But I don't think it was communicated well enough if that's what they were trying to do. Mm-hmm. But I understand what you mean.
I saw another one from the storyboards. They're like, oh, that's a dirtier joke that I realize. I'll get to it when we get there. But yeah.
You got to go to Disney, the master for hidden penises. You know what I mean? These are just TV guys doing their best. You need real Disney money to put a cock in something.
You can see Bart's penis right now on Disney Plus.
You really sure can. They were saving it for the movie.
Check out our We Hate Movies. We talk all about Bart's penis and the movies a little bit.
Also, something I didn't realize was a runner this season, just like the Thought Balloons, a woman relaxing in a bathtub and submerging her head below the water. Edna Krabappel did it. Marge did it. Yep. And here Selma does it. So it happened 3 times this season.
Wow. Wow. Okay.
Though this one, again, it's like, it's 1991. How do you say that a woman is relaxing and sexually excited? Has to be in a bathtub. The women can feel that no other place.
The male imagination was very limited in 1991.
And we're smoking a cigarette. The cigarette goes out as she goes in, which is a funny little gag.
That's great. Here's a big cut from the boards here. When Bob wants to improve things, he performs a Vita in a prison musical production, and he's in a white dress, like he is playing Evita in it and singing Don't Cry For Me, Argentina.
Oh, wow.
It's just one page of the storyboard. They don't say why it was cut. But
I assume it was the finger thing means the money, right?
I would bet. Mm. I would bet money, Also, they just did it in Dog of Death. They parody the Norman Rockwell Thanksgiving painting again.
This could be the 4th time so far they've done this in this series. They love that painting. It's a classic.
Well, Steven, I ask you as the movie guy, it's been a long time since I've seen Midnight Express, but don't you think her pressing her cheek is the reference to that scene in Midnight Express?
Yeah, it has to be. And it's a funny little gag of, you know, trying to be chaste and like, oh, we're being early. So it's like, I won't even fake kiss you with my mouth. I'm going to fake kiss you with my cheek. It's a funny little gag. I like it.
You know, I never flagged that as a Midnight Express gag, but it is. So many people have done their parody of it, I just forget. I'm thinking of the Cable Guy.
I think of the, oh, Billy moment from Cable Guy. Yes.
Yeah, the nipple.
When I finally watched Midnight Express, I was like, oh, this is far filthier than Cable Guy. The conjugal visit scene, this is when Snake gets his name. He first appeared in War of the Simpsons. His name in the script was Jailbird.
Because he was leaving jail.
Yeah, mm-hmm. He was like, oh, get up. Yeah, he's about to get out of jail and go to the party at the Simpsons place. And this is when they name him Snake, and you can see the big snake tattoo on his arm. Of course, though, this is a Wizard of Oz parody. The parodies are coming like eight deep. I've had to explain. We've explained so many.
I think we're still housed within a Cool Hand Luke parody.
Yes. Yeah.
Now, the word snake was in the script, and they're like, okay, we have a guy with a snake on his arm as a prisoner. Let's just use him. But certain writers are committed to his name being Jailbird, especially George Meyer. So... there are some later episodes in which he is called Jailbird, despite decades of him being Snake.
That's just being a jerk. Yeah. That's just literally like, no, that's it's in my script. I don't care. He's always been Jailbird to me. I never signed off on Snake. I wasn't on that episode.
It's like how Jim Starlin with Thanos comic did his own stories where he's like, no, my Thanos wouldn't lose to Kazar. That was a fake Thanos in that other comic. It's the retconning of that type of thing.
Jim Starlin, famously easy to work with.
Why he's his own artist on most things now. Yeah. And look, I love Jim Starlin. This is neither here nor there. Yeah, Lisa's line of you're living proof that the revolving door prison system works. Again, that's like, boy. Even mainstream liberal thinking was prisons are too nice. They're too nice to people. And just to put this in time, during this episode airing is the Rodney King trial. Like, that's happening. The verdict and the stuff that happens after that verdict is just about a week away from when this aired.
Wow.
Yeah. Just to give extra context to these jokes of, boy, people leave prison too soon, and it's too me.
When is Jolton Joe Biden's beautiful crime bill? That's got to be pretty close to around here.
You know, we're just 2 years after his sponsorship of the Cartoon All-Stars to the Rescue.
Yeah, he was too busy crafting that little miracle to work on the crime bill. He showed it to Strom Thurmond, right?
Yes, yeah.
Strom Thurmond was there.
He watched Alf and Garfield hang out. but yes, there's also another great bit of to show that Selma's giggling like a scroll girl, like her little like God, that's a great joke. This is when Bob does something shocking.
Selma, I've never seen you so happy giggling like a scroll girl. I've got to admit it, Selma, he's a once in a lifetime catch.
Yes, I hope the police are saying that as well.
I can't believe you guys. This man framed Krusty the Clown.
Bart.
Indeed I did. And I'd like to thank you for catching me, Bart. You seized the wheel of my slow boat to hell and pointed it straight towards the sunny shores of Selma.
Hear, hear.
Selma, would you mind if I did something bold and shocking in front of your family?
All right, but no tongues.
Although kissing you would be like kissing some divine ashtray. That's not what I had in mind. Selma, will you marry me?
Don't be fooled, Aunt Selma. That man is scum.
Then call me Mrs. Scum.
It's so great that you can tell Bob is masking his rage over having to be with this woman, but he's so eloquent that no one picks up on it with comments like that divine ashtray thing.
He's full of passive-aggressive disses to her. He is so velvety-tongued that nobody's mad about it. They're like, oh, what a smart guy.
It's actually interesting thinking about Homer. I guess they didn't have enough time for it, but this is probably the nicest he is to Patty and Selma. Like, he does not jump in. He says, here, here, when Bob celebrates Selma, as opposed to saying, like, that's you, buddy, or whatever, another Homer kind of a thing. Legend of the Dog-Faced Woman kind of a scenario.
Bob is just that charming, I guess. Yeah, and then once Homer finds out about hors d'oeuvres, well,
right,
he's not going to argue against his wedding.
I was trying to think, the meanest he is in this episode is when Marge says, now I know we're all excited to meet Selma's new boyfriend. And Elmer goes and rolls his eyes. That's as mean as it gets. So everybody's convinced with Bart. And then we come back from commercial break. We have returned to the Happy Sumo. This is where Groening gave his note on, like, be careful. And originally they wanted to be Don't Go Breaking My Heart, the Elton John Kiki D song, but they couldn't clear it. They said that they tried to get Kiki D and they couldn't find her. So now, you know what? I'm still kicking myself. My husband and I had plans to go to Elton John's final show in Los Angeles, but unfortunately the new job he got meant we couldn't make it. So we saw him in San Francisco and it was still great, but we knew they'd have a cooler stuff for the final Los Angeles show. And it included Kiki D made a surprise unplanned appearance and sang Don't Go Breaking My Heart live on stage with him. Yeah.
I think he's coming back.
Honestly, his farewell tour still has about, I think, at least another 12 months of stuff everywhere but America.
Okay.
Yeah.
So book your tickets now, folks. So instead of that song, we have Something Stupid. I did a bit of research about this song and I was like, all right, who does the popular version? And I looked it up. It says Frank Sinatra and his daughter, Nancy Sinatra. And then I was like, well, this is weird. It's a love song, but it's a father and a daughter singing. And then Nancy Sinatra is on record saying, quote, some people call Something Stupid the incest song, which I think is, well, very sweet.
God.
Yeah.
And
I think her tongue was firmly in her cheek, Henry.
Okay. All right, man. I mean, these Italian families are close, man.
hey, another Sinatra reference is coming up very soon.
I know I stand in line until I think you have the time to spend an evening with me.
And if we go someplace to dance, I know that there's a chance you won't be leaving with me.
Then afterwards we drop into a quiet little place and have a drink or two. And then I go and spoil it all by saying something stupid like I love you.
You know, I'm glad they use this stupid, weird. I mean, it also adds an extra layer to this that Bob and Selma are singing a father-daughter love song, but in a loving way. It makes it more weird, too.
Well, it was never intended to be a father-daughter love song.
Yeah.
They were just sung by a father and daughter.
That's true. I'm glad it's this song instead of Don't Go Breaking My Heart. I feel like it's more played out. You hear it more places. Once it has been covered by Miss Piggy with Elton John, it's like, your parody's not going to be better.
Kelsey Grammer crushes it. It's just hitting every single syllable perfectly. I wonder how this is a bit more, not somber isn't the right word. It's less peppy than Don't Go Breaking My Heart, which I think wouldn't have lent as well to Grammer's voice or the Sideshow Bob character.
It's also a very good juxtaposition to have Kelsey Grammer singing in his beautiful voice and then Julie Kavner, who never thought she'd be singing in this show, singing in this crazy voice next to him.
I wonder if it's easier to sing with Selma in her deeper voice than Marge in her higher voice.
Yeah.
I hope it's at least a little easier on her voice. Though, as she said on the commentary, it doesn't affect her at all. She's just fine. And yeah, we have some fun little love scenes here. The Blinky in the water as they're doing a paddle boat. Footprints on the beach with his giant feet. A skipping scene intentionally meant to be a sequel to the Land of Chocolate Homer skipping bit, which is really great. And okay, here's something else that, like, this was a dirtier, slightly dirtier joke in the storyboards.
That's what I assumed. Henry, drop the truth on us.
So yes, it's all about framing, because the joke is you see Selma, she is in ecstasy. And then the camera pulls back. She's getting a foot rub. In the original framing, she is laid down on the bed and you see her head only and her ecstasy. And the camera pans down her body. And you are supposed to think oral is happening there. And then it's the reveal of the rubbing feet.
You know, I'm surprised they couldn't do that, because in War of the Simpsons, they did a similar joke in which Homer sends Bart to bed. Bart says, you can't have any fun in bed. And then Homer has a dream sequence remembering something. We see his upper half and he's moaning, and then we pull out to see he's holding a sandwich, but you don't see his lower half, so oral sex is being implied there. And I only got that upon this recent viewing.
If I hadn't seen the storyboards, I would have been like, oh, that's what you're supposed to take from that. I think a censor made them not frame it differently. I think if you just zoom in, it could all just be done in the post-production editing.
Yeah.
Just zoom in more on Selma's face on the pan out, it works better, but
we need to be a little clearer that we're not having sex, really.
I always remember this from that film is not yet rated movie about American Ratings Board. Could be one of those things where, like, American censors, they are more offended by feminine pleasure than male pleasure as well. So could also be that.
Well, it's just scary to imagine a woman's orgasm.
Obviously, all the people rating it have never seen it before. So they're just like, what is this thing?
Our founding fathers had no idea.
Or I should say the mythical female orgasm. I don't know.
Yeah.
I've never seen it personally.
It's all made up, if you ask me.
She's faking it.
Wow, we're just a couple episodes away from that show.
Yeah, yeah.
Then we see Mole Man. Also, this is a sequel joke to Principal Charming, because Selma has experience with all of her previous dates in this episode, actually. Here she's really nice to Mole Man and lets him drive even though he's blind. And grading even on the storyboards, he's like, don't make him more small and freakish than previous show. He's very defensive about Mole Man.
He doesn't like Mole Man. At least I think Mole Man grew on him, as he grew on all of us, before he was known as Mole Man.
All right. And now it's time for the longest explanation of a background reference here.
Well, thank you once again for joining us, Steve, for another tangent.
I'm excited.
As we talk about the Jerry Lewis MDA Labor Day telethon.
Oh,
now, Steve, was this a part of your life when you were like a little kid?
Yes. Okay. We would watch these. I remember at least watching one or two, but it was something that was definitely like my experience with it never outshone how much pop culture was talking about it or how much pop culture would love to make fun of Jerry Lewis for this thing. You know what I mean?
We'll explain what it is in a second here. But this confused me as a kid because I had never seen a Jerry Lewis movie. They weren't really in circulation. I still really haven't seen one. And my parents would watch it. My grandma would watch it like, oh, Jerry Lewis, the funniest guy you've ever seen. His movies were falling down in the aisles. And then you see this like sweaty, mawkish man singing ballads.
Yes. Yeah.
And being very serious, there was like cognitive dissonance. I'm like, he's the funniest guy you've ever seen?
You know, I barely watched the telethons because I was born on Labor Day of 1982, and my birthday is always either on or around Labor Day. So I'm doing birthday stuff that weekend. I'm not paying attention to the telethon on TV.
This had a big footprint in pop culture because the Jerry Lewis MDA telethon, that stands for Muscular Dystrophy Association, a great cause, to be fair.
Yep.
But there's some things worth making fun of. This ran from 66 until 2010. It ran for up to 22 hours, and the highlight was watching Jerry Lewis get increasingly sweaty and melodramatic and sleep-deprived, and
yes.
This always ended with him singing You'll Never Walk Alone, often dragging one of the sufferers of this disability onto stage
one
with him.
One of his kids.
Yes.
Jerry's kids.
And, you know, you watch Barney was an insult, so was like, oh, you're one of Jerry's kids. That was another insult.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Yes. I feel like also there was a really mean In Loving Color sketch about this one. I'm almost positive. I haven't watched it in 30 years, but like thinking back, I'm like, oh yeah, someone's playing one of the kids, and it's like,
ooh,
got it.
Maybe probably Jim Carrey. We'll just say,
more than likely,
could be Damon Wayans.
Yes,
could be.
He was handy man. And I will say, back to Mystery Science Theater. If you're a Mystery Science Theater fan, the Satellite of Love is probably named after a reference to this, in which Jerry would say, "Oh, this is being beamed out to you through the Satellite of Love." And yes, there's a Lou Reed song called that, but it's probably based on this because this is such embedded in the mind of boomers, Gen Xers, and even us.
And again, this long telethon that would air every year for decades, it also has a bigger impact when there's four channels on television.
Mm-hmm.
And like you said, Jerry Lewis stopped appearing in movies at a certain point in time. Basically, he did like one movie a decade for the rest of his life, but he'd always be on this thing. You'd always see Jerry Lewis on this. And you'd also have all of his aging alongside him, slowly dying off, Hollywood pals appearing on it too. You're like, oh, so that's what happened to like Ed McMahon or whatever.
He was in a talk show with Elf.
Yes.
That's what happened to him.
This is a reference that is very specific. Oh, and also they are very careful that this is a thing for children suffering from motion sickness. So they are not mocking. That was a big deal for graining on the notes of like, do not mock people with muscular dystrophy or any other serious disease.
Right. So yes, this is a parody of the Dean Martin and Jerry Lewis reunion at this telethon in 1976. And if you need a refresher, Martin Lewis were the hottest comedy act of the 50s. They went on to be in 16 movies together. Over time, Dean Martin, a hateful drunk, was getting very mad about Jerry Lewis getting all the attention, all the best lines. You know, he was the star, essentially. Increasingly fraught their relationship was. And then at the end of shooting of their last movie, they just never spoke again personally for 20 years. And suddenly, at this telethon, Frank Sinatra, he's invited. He's planned to be there. He's got a special guest. And I've never watched this clip until now. And I thought, oh, it must have been very heartwarming. And I'm sure it was a huge moment for boomers and Gen Xers. Like, wow, this comedy team being reunited. Well, I did know that being a drunk was Dean Martin's kind of persona, being like a lovable drunk. in this clip, he is uncomfortably drunk. It's an uncomfortable scene, and it makes me feel bad. And it feels like more a prank on a drunk person than an actual sincere reuniting of this comedy team, because Jerry Lewis is looking at him like, you fucking mess. You're here and you have no idea. You're never going to remember this. It just feels like he's trying to get through it. And then Frank Sinatra wants to sing a duet with Dean and he cannot fucking do it. He is just lost. It's a sad scene. But then I look at the YouTube comments. No one's mentioning that. They're like, wow, such great performers. They're on the stage together. Oh, such love in their eyes. Oh, it's amazing. But to me, a jaded elder millennial, I just see a sad, drunken man about to just, on the last legs of his life, basically.
He's drunker than you're allowed to be on television. And you can be a little buzzed for the Oscars, you know what I mean? You'll see somebody like, oh, that someone's a little out there. But like, no, that's 60s drunk. You have to wake up real early to get going.
Yeah, Dean Martin is like 1:30 a.m. Halloween drunk and you're about 23 yes. years old.
It is so uncomfortable. I agree. I'd never watched the whole thing until Bob linked me to it, because I'd only seen it in Jerry Lewis biography or retrospective on his career, where they say, and then of course me and Dean, we did meet up together again, and they show like 4 seconds from this. I watched Jerry Lewis talk about this. It was a year after Dean Martin died on the Larry King show, and he was like, and it was so sweet, and Dean came to my turf and that showed a lot of respect and I love seeing him. And then he played 2 seconds of it and then he's like, it was great, I miss him. But yes, when you actually hear it, I have a clip here.
Yeah, I mean, I don't know if you captured this, but Frank Sinatra's like, get a room, you fucking homos.
Yes.
Basically, yeah, he makes a homophobic joke about them hugging each other.
Here's some more extra context to this. I don't know where it was regularly done, but this year's, in 76, MDA Telethon was done in Las Vegas. So that's why everybody's extra fucked
He's
up.
Las Vegas drunk.
Yeah. Yes.
Holy crap. Yeah.
So here's the clip.
You know, it seems like we haven't seen each other for 20 years.
Yeah. Well, you know, there was all those rumors about our breaking up, and then when I started the show and you weren't here, I believed it.
I'll show you guys to your room if you like. The lights are out upstairs, so follow me.
He drinks
a lot, this kid.
So, you working?
I work 6 weeks a year at the Megum.
The Megum?
And 6 days I do a roast. And
would you excuse us a minute?
Okay. I had an extra 40 seconds. It's like, I'm cringing. Just
You got to see it, folks. Very uncomfortable. This is why characters like Barney were created. People from this generation were used to seeing drunk celebrities on TV.
Yeah, yes. And that Vegas context helped me more, because he's like, do 6 weeks a year at the Megum. He means the MGM brand.
Yeah.
But he's like pointing. He's like, yeah, on the street or that one.
Mega Man, 6 weeks a year. You know.
What's extra funny is I see this clip first, and then last night I looked up. There was a 40th anniversary article of it happening in Vanity Fair in 2016, talking to basically the few remaining living people who were involved in it and the children of Dean Martin and Jerry Lewis. And not once is drinking mentioned at all. And none of this. They're just like, oh, it was so beautiful. What a great. They do frame it, though, as Frank Sinatra playing a prank on basically both of them on live TV. And then also Frank Sinatra hid Dean Martin in Ed McMahon's dressing room. That's how they got away with it.
Hi-yo.
And then also Peter Bogdanovich was there. And after the show, he was like, guys, I'm going to do a reunion movie with you. I can do it. It all fell apart. It never happened. Yeah. Could Dean Martin actually film a film in like 1982?
No.
Like, no. No.
You need to be able to speak to do that.
Even Cannonball Run, it's like, all right, 5 minutes. He sits in the car the whole time. Like, he doesn't have to act. So anyway, all of that is because they parody that directly in this episode of The Simpsons, because the young people who saw this major moment in 1976 grew up to be writers on The Simpsons and never forgot this moment. And I feel like it was so remembered by kids of then, because it was just a playground tale. You didn't tape it off TV. Mm-hmm. Maybe the news would replay it, but pretty much it just grew in its story of like, isn't it amazing? They were friends again. And also, they never hung out again after that. It's like they maybe saw each other like 2 birthdays the rest of their lives, according to that Vanity Fair piece. I think that too, it makes crusty Jerry Lewis, which always works.
Yeah.
And it makes Sideshow Bob Dean Martin, where he's pretending to, he's like, hey, we're all friends again, when actually he hates that he's starting to be made fun of again by Jerry Lewis. In Bob's case, kicked in the butt in front of everybody. The Crustula and Bob reconnect.
And now, a man who needs no introduction. The chairman of the company. You know who I'm talking about. Get out here, you Goomba.
Crustula, there's an old friend backstage who wants to say hello.
Huh? What?
I can't believe it. Oh, they've been feuding for years.
Come here, you.
Oh, you old clown. Oh, I missed you. This guy is a national treasure.
That jerk I got to replace you, he isn't fit to hold your slide whistle.
All I can be is myself.
Crusty, can you ever forgive me for framing you and putting you in jail?
Hey, if they ever open the books on this telethon, I'm right back in there.
That sideshow Bob is a no-good showbiz phony.
Come on, Bart. If Krusty can find it in his heart to forgive him, surely you can, too.
Oh, Krusty, I can't tell you how much I miss this.
It's so funny how Krusty is such a hack that his act is just kicking a man in the ass very hard.
Mm-hmm. I'm going to pull on your pants, kick you. That's all he's got.
That's their 1-2 punch, yeah.
Krusty is a bully of comedy. It's also, as a kid, him calling out the chairman of the company, and it's clearly a Sinatra thing. Flew over my head like I barely knew who Frank Sinatra was. Actually, as a kid growing up, I would see the Looney Tunes making fun of young Frank Sinatra, and my mom had to tell me, like, no, you know that old guy on TV, that's who they're making fun of in those Looney Tunes.
Well, you know, earlier we were talking about the female orgasm. I was just thinking about those cartoons where they would get the Frank Sinatra chicken to sing and the female chicken would just explode with eggs.
That's right, yes. Ooh, Frankie.
Back in the 30s, they knew.
And that's why the men hated Frank Sinatra, because he was making all these ladies swoon,
Him being like a pretty boy has just always been like, and I mean, look, he's an attractive young man when you look at him, but it's just, it always strikes me as like, that's an odd fit. Like, he was like a Timothy Chalamet type, but he was in the New Jersey Mafia, essentially, is what we're getting at.
You know, in 1943, they didn't know what to do with a Timothy Chalamet. It's handed to him. No. They're like, what the fuck is
Send him to war.
Is that the first we were hearing from Sideshow Mel, like his actual voice?
Yes, with a butt. Yeah. So what he's saying in Radio Bart as a parody of Bruce Springsteen and We Are the World, this is the first time we hear him talk, but it is the same voice.
Yeah.
But it's essentially Dan Castellaneta admittedly doing a Kelsey Grammer impression.
I love his sadness, like, all I can be is myself. Like, it's so sad. And again, Sideshow Mel, a beloved member of the Simpsons family. But Bob is happy to be abused again, or at least he pretends that. And even Lisa, is fooled, if you heard there. Mm-hmm. So then we cut to them planning the wedding in the Simpsons kitchen. That's how Bart can walk in and hear all of these details. Honestly, Marge, why is she so obsessed with purity? Let Selma wear white on her wedding day, man. That's...
Come on, it's the 90s, as we love to say in the 90s. It's the 90s, let it go.
Well, the one good thing Selma gets out of this is losing her virginity at 41, so.
It's so funny, yeah. She really, there's a dirty joke at the end of this episode about her getting laid.
Mm-hmm. Oh, yeah.
So, yeah, Bart's listening into all of it. Homer mentions how much he loves cocktail weenies. He also had Swedish meatballs to it. So this fits in with the Homer love of pork chops in that it's cheap crap.
Comes out of a can usually, right?
That he describes it as, they taste as good as they look about cocktail weenies. And of course, brother, it ain't ketchup. What a great line.
I am exactly Homer Simpson here, although not cocktail weenies. You know, I'll be honest, I don't like them raw dogged. I appreciate needs to be a firm pig in a blanket. Now we're talking, and that I could eat 40 to 60 of those and then hate myself, but I can do it.
You see, these days it's been killed by the slider.
Yeah, the slider. Mm-hmm.
The slider is taking over wedding food, like little cupcakes.
Cupcakes, I was going to say, cupcakes, very popular. Mm-hmm.
I was at my mom's second wedding. Obviously, I didn't attend her first one. I wasn't born yet. So.
A likely story.
And of course, a trencherman is a person who eats in a specified manner, typically heartily, according to Webster's, which obviously is a fancy way of calling someone fat, which is what Bob is very pissed off in this, but he's barely masking it with fancy words.
I love the, I've already spent the $8 out of $10 that the prison gave me.
So here's the big clue. This, though, is the big change also from the storyboard. One, I said it before, but the reason she says she's rich is from those lawsuits. But two, she did not lose it from a bottle rocket. She says that a few years ago, she entered into a jalapeno eating contest and lost her sense of taste and smell that way.
Okay.
So
Bottle Rocket's funnier.
I think it's funnier too.
Yeah, for sure.
Though it makes me sadder to know that she's spent the last 40 years of her life not being able to taste or smell anything. I kind of prefer it if it's like, oh, if it's only been the last few years, it's not as tragic. Though I guess we see with Patty that even if she had her sense of taste and smell, she'd be just as angry and mean anyway. Mm-hmm. So
didn't and the cigarettes her. Would dull everything else out anyway. Your palate is a bit dulled That's by true. That much smoking.
I love, too, that Bob says your less tangible qualities. Like, he can't name something, actually, yes. that he would love about her. It is just for her money. And here's another big cut from the storyboards. While Bob is comforting her, Bart is looking at him, and Bob turns into a snake. It's like the Grim Reaper vision he has later.
Yes. Silverman mentions that. I think he misremembers it as actually being in the episode still.
Maybe it got animated and cut, but it's definitely there on the storyboards. Then we learn for the first time Bob's last name, Mrs. Bob Terwilliger. It'll not be until Sideshow Bob Roberts when we learn his middle name.
Like many things in The Simpsons named after a street in Portland. I've been on Terwilliger Street.
Wow.
Yeah. They're all there. Lovejoy, Flanders, Kearney. Go to Portland. You'll find all the Simpsons streets there.
They're being driven around in a hansom cab by previous Selma date Barney Gumble.
I do love the British accent he affects. Yes, sure thing, Mom, which he does, which is fantastic.
Don't spare the whip.
Yes.
Yeah, so you mentioned this, Henry, that Barney has dated Selma before. You can't remember this, but they were on a date in Principal Charming at Moe's. But we have Selma saying she invested in Mace, but Patty is the one who maced Barney twice in War of the Simpsons and Saturdays of Thunder. So she was the macing character of the two. But I like how in these first three seasons, Barney, Patty, and Selma have all these connections that are just lost.
They're a real trio.
Well, yeah, you'd imagine they'd be at the same New Year's Eve party a couple of times. You know what I mean? Homer has Barney there, Patty and Selma. Things get a little, they're on the same couch. Who knows what's going to happen? This also is a great clue that Patty can't smell is because they are in a hansom cab and no one is retching from the horse.
I've never ridden in one. They're pretty regular in your neck of the woods.
Yeah, I never have either because it's just such a cruel and sad endeavor. But when you approach Central Park, which I do, you know, once or twice a year, half a block away, you can smell them. It's just, here is the horse shit, and I have to walk past this to get into this beautiful park, and I will never be in a hansom cab ride.
Maybe that Seinfeld episode about the hansom cab really turned off a generation to him.
And the MacGyver stuff came in Homer Alone, right? When Bart and Lisa were with Patty and Selma, Richard Dean Anderson will be in my dreams tonight, one of them said.
Yeah. MacGyver was just one of the many weird things they have, like Kamado and Mr. Pibb and tongue sandwiches and all that. But this time they're like, you know what? We said MacGyver in that one. Let's just go all the way. MacGyver's their favorite show. We said it before. MacGyver is basically over at this point.
So it'll be over in like 6 weeks.
Yes.
So they really hit on it too late because it had been on since like 86 or something. It had been on for a while. Yeah.
I'm just curious if that MacGyver reboot made it.
No, it actually is on its like fifth season or something.
Oh, yeah. Okay. It's over. It's 2016 to 2021. It wrapped up.
Isn't that fucking crazy? It had probably almost as many episodes as regular MacGyver. It's crazy. Yeah, it messed me up when I was trying to find, because I wanted to see what night of the week did MacGyver air. Was it against The Simpsons? And it was normally a Saturday or Sunday night show. But my first search was like, oh, okay, it aired on that. Wait, 2022? Oh, no, okay. I mean, it's like there were 8 million episodes of the Hawaii Five-0 show, and I totally forget that too.
Yeah.
Getting older is forgetting that shows are on TV now.
And forgetting that old people watch television.
Oh, yeah, Steve, I mean, you do Melrose 210, your sideshow for We Hate Movies. You cover Melrose Place and 90210. Doesn't that always interfere with your searching for 90210? I think there's two reboots.
Yes, the full-on reboot of It's 20 Years Later, and like we have, like, I think it's Jackie's kid is the hero of the story, and blah, blah, blah. And like some friends that we remember might stop by to wish us well from the first series. And then we have that like weird one season, which happened months after Luke Perry died, of all of the original cast doing a meta kind of like, oh, are we going to do a reboot of the show kind of a thing that existed for only one season. Again, I think Perry death definitely hurt that show specifically.
And, you know, if you're missing Luke Perry, though, his son doing great work in All Elite Wrestling.
Well, no wrestling, Henry. Here it comes.
I'm sorry. But, yeah, you know, Luke Perry reminded me. I forget about it. I just went to a pay-per-view event where one of the major matches was Jack Perry. This is going to sound very morbid to explain it context-free. It was a casket match where he buries alive his opponent because his opponent insulted his dead father, Luke Perry, too many times. He's I'm going to bury you.
Too soon.
Yeah.
I would be like, hey, man, can we not make that part of our characters? Like, can we just do, like, I don't know, my haircut, where I'm from?
He's just as hot as Luke Perry was, that Jack Perry.
They were just so vicious to these ABC shows on this episode. You know what sucks? Dinosaurs. Also, fuck MacGyver.
And I mean, we really go knives out for MacGyver here. And again, grammar just fucking kills it. It's just him doing this whole bit, and the sarcasm is my favorite part that wasn't poorly written.
Yes. Sideshow Bob hates MacGyver in our next clip.
Tomorrow will be Mr. and Mrs. Bob Terwilliger. Isn't it grand?
Hey, Bob, give some of that honey this way. Holy free holies! We've got 10 minutes till MacGyver. Driver, here's a fin. Get me home and don't spare the whip.
Whatever you say, Mom.
What did I miss? MacGyver was wearing a tank top. Dang.
Why, Selma, I thought I was the only man in your life.
Sit down and shut up.
Thank you, Senor MacGyver. You've saved our village.
Don't thank me. Thank the moon's gravitational pull.
That MacGyver's a genius.
First of all, he's not a genius. He's an actor. And second, he's not much of an actor.
You're lying. You're lying!
No, Selma, this is lying. That was a well-plotted piece of non-claptrap that never made me want to retch.
No! He was so cruel. The things he said, they're just not true.
That's so great that she's having this reaction after, like, you know, that he said mean things about her, but she's like, it's true about MacGyver. Now, I will say, occasionally I have been this sensitive about pro wrestling. If my husband didn't like something on pro wrestling, I've been a little defensive.
Did you kick an ottoman across the room like Selma does?
No, I didn't do that. But I love Bob's acting, like when he's tapping, that wasn't us making noise on it. It was the tapping of his fingers, like, when is this going to be over?
Yeah.
Oh, God. And what a great line of bad writing of thank the moon's gravitational pull. Like, that's such a, which I guess means that the tides helped save the day in some way in the plot of the episode.
I mean, despite them making fun of Richard Dean Anderson's acting abilities, he would come to the show in season 17 playing himself. Basically, Patty and Selma kidnap him.
From a Stargate convention.
Yeah.
Steven, did you ever check out that Stargate series he was on?
I never did. I've told the story a couple of times. I had a friend of the family, like, it was a big family function, and, like, he asked me that question, and I said no, and the right answer is, like, oh, cool, you should probably check it out. He proceeded to tell me 6 seasons of stories for about an hour and a half while we were kind of playing pool. And I'm like, this is still going on.
You know, Steve, I had a similar experience with a Stargate fan. Yes. I was trying to date. I was getting to know this woman in college and, you know, just chatting and stuff, meeting at a bar a few times. And then she brought up Stargate and she would talk about it a bunch. And I'm like, I don't know if I want to get involved with this. And then eventually she ghosted me and I was like, okay.
You were going to have to watch all of the Stargate tapes with her.
Hey, they were DVDs. Oh, I didn't go to college in 1993.
Okay, you're right. Yeah, Stargate was another one I never touched. And I like the movie Stargate just fine.
Yeah, for sure.
Yeah. So, okay, all right. So Sideshow Bob definitely hates MacGyver, that he's not acting here. But is him not suppressing his hatred of MacGyver part of his plan? Like, when he sees that they smoke when the episode's over, this is how he creates his alibi. He says, okay, then I'll just take a walk while you're on MacGyver, thus creating his alibi. And he notices that she lights a cigarette after MacGyver, thus the murder weapon.
I think Homer even gives him the idea for how to have an alibi, unwittingly, of course.
I think it's funnier if it's read as Sideshow Bob is in the middle of this murder plot, but cannot suppress how much he hates MacGyver. The right move is like, oh, it's great, you know, but not for me. You watch it by yourself. They almost break up because he can't stand the poor writing and the poor acting.
It's the one thing he can't hold back. He can hold back how much he hates Bart even, but
yes, he could have sex with her even if he doesn't want to, but he cannot watch a MacGyver.
In 2023, he could just look at his phone the entire time, right?
Yes.
Exactly. Yeah, that's what my husband does sometimes during pro wrestling. My husband loves pro wrestling, but not as much as me.
Sounds like he doesn't, Henry.
Not as much as me. I do also like Homer's description of what makes a happy marriage. Of like, well, if she watches something nonviolent, I just leave, get drunk, and come home wanting sex. Like,
it's a great progression. It's like, you know, you just leave, you go for a walk, you're like, oh, that's nice. And then it's like, you go to the bar, you're drunk, you come back, and now she's ready to go. It's like, yeah, that's fine.
The one line that hits with a thud is Bart's Tonto reference, where it is so lost to time now, but it's him imitating Tonto from The Lone Ranger, where the bad medicine thing.
Bad medicine.
Oh, yes.
I tried looking for clips where Tonto, the character, the Native American friend of The Lone Ranger, I tried watching a Lone Ranger episode that's on YouTube, bored the shit out of me. And like, you can see why kids of the time remember Tonto. He's the only interesting guy. But it was comedians who grew up with it. They would do jokes of Tonto no like blank blah 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 and something after. Yeah. And in this case, Bart no like bad medicine.
I think what threw you off is there's an episode called Bad Medicine of The Lone Ranger, which just destroys the SEO for you trying to find Tonto saying that.
Yeah, I blame the remaining Lone Ranger fandom that doesn't transcribe these episodes that I could find the script for it.
He's only 95 years old, Henry. You can't put that much on that poor man.
You know, it was only recently, thanks to comic books, that I learned that Lone Ranger and the Green Hornet are continuity connected. They're in the same universe.
Oh.
The Lone Ranger is like the ancestor of the Green Hornet. It's what inspires the Green Hornet to become the Green Hornet. I learned it from the recent, and by recent, I mean, I guess like 10 years ago, Mark Waid written reboot of it, which if you're going to read any Green Hornet comics, those are the ones to read.
I dread this, but I feel like at some point there will be a Disney Plus Lone Ranger series. If they gave us a Willow series, there's no stopping them.
Yeah. Any IP they have, they'll skin that cat, and it's much more profitable to have a series than a movie.
They tried it with the Tonto movie, and I think they realized, like, okay, this costs too much, but if we just put people in the volume and put on a Lone Ranger mask, and also actually hire someone of Native American background instead of a drunk guy who says he has Native American ancestry.
Okay, he said his 23andMe was in the mail.
Oh, that fucking guy. The wedding is here. Lisa is jealous that Maggie is the flower girl because she keeps falling down. It's a cute little scene, though not in my taped version, so it always feels new to me every time I watch it on the DVD. And
yeah, it's an interesting move for Lisa to be bitter about this. I like it. I like it.
Her and Maggie don't have enough competition as sisters.
Yes.
And here's another crazy thing from the boards. There's not even a joke for it, but Homer is the man giving away Selma in the boards. Like, he's the one walking her down the aisle.
Oh, I guess it's because their dad is dead. So that makes sense. Yeah.
And then the Grim, if you check on the DVDs too, there's some fun prelim art of Silverman designing the Grim Reaper version of Bob, as he says, I do. As a kid, I thought that they were going to interrupt their wedding. I was like, oh, well, they're not going to actually get married. Then like, oh, they did. Look at that.
It looks really similar to the Grim Reaper you see in the Homer Goes to Hell as the judge. It's a very similar, like, skinny-faced kind of design.
Yeah, they're both Silverman episodes, right?
That's right. Yeah. You're right. Yeah, both Silverman directed. So that makes sense. So then I guess this happens in a lot of movies. A cut on a champagne cork popping, isn't that a Godfather thing? Isn't that from Godfather?
Possibly. Yeah. Possibly.
It feels vaguely Godfather to me.
So this next scene is the wedding reception, and they're not in the Simpsons timeline in which they're comfortable with just filling the room with all of our friends. Like, Sideshow Mel is there and Krusty. Well, Krusty is there, but let's say Dr. Hibbert.
Yeah.
You know, but just like your standard stock Springfield character. So they're like, who would be here? And it's funny, we get, Krusty, of course, but also Moe and Barney are invited.
Their only joke is just drinking.
Yeah.
It is interesting how considered it is. You know what I mean? And I think it's considered also with how they film it with Marge as a camera, you know what I mean? Which we're actually going to reference in a couple of minutes anyway. It's going to be crucial to the plot. The camera's here. We're like going through it. We, you know, Krusty say something funny for the camera. 12-inch pianist. You know, it's very movie-like.
It was really helpful for filmmakers when the personal video camera existed. Of like, oh, you can just have people give testimonials at things now. Because everybody has VCR. And now, even easier to film everything with your phone. I love the overhead shot of Homer eating from all of the trays at once. They're all parked in front of him. And also the Larry Davis Experience is back from another Silverman co-directed episode. some enchanted Eve thing. Patty is disgusted at the idea of like, well, I'm alone, but at least it could be worse. I could be with Homer, which is funny now because currently on the show, her long-term partner, Evelyn, is written to be a Homer type, a real mega slob lesbo played by Fortune Feimster. I like the Evelyn episodes. It's fun.
I guess Patty not aware of her sexuality or deeply closeted.
Deeply closeted. Yeah. Also, it's funny too to hear Al Jean on the commentary have to talk about his, he makes sure to say from my wedding, my first wedding. This bit with Krusty, future Simpsons writer Tom Gammel was at Al Jean's wedding. Gary Shandling was there because I would bet Al Jean was writing on It's the Gary Shandling Show at the time. And Tom Gammel came up to him with a camera and said, hey, do something funny, Gary. And he wasn't as funny as Krusty in this. I mean, that has to really suck to be a Gary Shandling at any wedding of just, you're going to have somebody come up to you and be like, hey, funny man, come on.
Make me laugh.
I need a joke when someone asks me to tell them a joke because I just don't have any in my back pocket.
Yeah, boy, I got to save one of those too. That's good plan.
Especially if you're a comedy podcaster.
Mm-hmm.
That's why whenever I'm in an Uber, especially if we're on the tour or something, I'll just be like, I'm here for a wedding. Just meeting some friends from out of town. That's the way to do that.
See, that's why it takes like five questions deep before I should head it off in the past with that wedding thing. In the driver conversation world, I'm not one of those people who's like, never talk to me, driver.
No, of course not.
But if they ask like, so what do you do? My first thing is like a website job.
Yeah.
If they keep going for five more questions, then I'm like, it's a podcast, all right. Oh, what is it? I'll look it up. I'm like, yeah, I'm sure you will.
They have to go down the conversation tree like it's Bioware game or something.
This is when Bob reveals his evil plans.
On the advice of my new husband, I've decided to give up smoking. Except for after meals and after MacGyver.
Why, Selma, dear, you'll bury us all.
Chief Wiggum, you've been around. You don't trust Sideshow Bob, do you?
Ah, lighten up, son. If he was going to commit a crime, would he have invited the number one cop in town? Now, where did I put my gun? Oh, yeah. I set it down when I got a piece of cake.
Yes!
Okay. I don't know what to say. Just tell me what you know I want to hear. I'm dying of jealousy. Thank you.
That's right, dear. Enjoy your rest. The wedding was very tough on you, and the honeymoon is going to be murder.
I now notice that they're following the pattern of the first Sideshow Bob episode 2. Act 2 ends with the evil laughter of Sideshow Bob revealing his secret plan all along. Mm-hmm. So following a pattern here. You think that he's doing this to help Selma, but it's right before the clip. Even then, when trying to give his nice speech to her, he still says what her weight is to all of her family.
And her age.
Yes, they're right. It's her weight and age. Yeah. 168 pounds of clay and made a woman. It's not accidental, you're right. It's just him being passive aggressive, letting out his anger. And also, of course, in the real world, Kelsey Grammer he's gone through a lot of wives. That's for sure.
Gone through? They all survived.
Yes.
And I don't think three of them would weigh 168 pounds, honestly.
That's true.
Yeah.
And Steve, up front, you were mentioning the lighting. This scene, especially of them in the car, like the lighting is very odd because they're lit by, you know, the interior of the car, the lights that are on. And then as he starts laughing, the lighting changes. It's very sophisticated for TV animation. It's very effective, too.
Just something that you don't see a lot anymore as things become more computerized and so quick. It's considered. There's a consideration to how will this lighting affect the scene.
And I love the reveal that his license plate is I Hate Bart to show he's still evil.
No one noticed that at the wedding.
God, I also like when this all came together for me now, I was like, oh yeah, Sideshow Bob hates Selma so much that he can't even wait like a month into their wedding. He's like, you know what? During the honeymoon, I gotta kill this lady. And honestly, if he could have had the honeymoon be the night MacGyver aired, it would have killed her that night. But it seems to be like 3 or 4 days into the honeymoon since they can send a videotape from where they are.
Yeah, I was actually doing the timeline for the first time because one like nagging thing about this episode is like, how did they have time to send a videotape back to the Simpsons? Yep. The timeline is MacGyver airs, the wedding is the next day, and then that means there's basically 6 days before Selma smokes that fake its cigarettes. So I think there's enough time, if that resort has a post office, to get a tape back to the Simpsons. But it's very odd to send a vacation tape as your vacation is in progress, right?
I guess if you're as vain as Patty is about having world's greatest husband, you want to rub it in everybody's face. You'll next day that shit and you make sure that Patty also has a copy.
And there is a sign late in the episode that for this episode, Shelbyville is only 34 miles away. So they actually can drive there within an hour. So next day would come the next day.
That sign is very funny because it's in the neighbor's yard across the street.
That's true.
Welcome to our video honeymoon. We're using the video camera Cousin Dot gave us and the video cassette Homer gave us.
Hey, and after we watch this, we can tape over it.
There's Shelbyville Falls, Rolling Rock, and here's another breathtaking sight. My brand new hubby.
I wanted a room with a fireplace, you brainless luggage monkey. Like the one in your brochure.
Oh, Selma, dear. I was just chatting with my good friend, Dennis. Now, smile for the camera. That's a good lad. Ah, fire. Scourge of Prometheus, toaster of marshmallows, eradicator of dead wood. Oh, Selma, dear, you and your little camera. What do you say we shut it off for a while?
And make love?
I suppose so.
Oh, that's sweet.
Why would Sideshow Bob go so nuts over a fireplace?
Because he wants his honeymoon to be romantic.
Romantic? With Aunt Selma?
I guess you're just too young to understand.
And I also love that Homer gifted them a VHS tape. Yes. And Homer's just like, oh, we'll tape right over it. Like, basically just got my tape back.
Hey, use SLP mode on that.
Oh, definitely, dude. Thanks to Aunt Dot for the camera and for Homer for the videotape.
Oh, and her distorted face when she's doing basically a selfie with her VHS camera. Oh, so good.
I think my brain is ruined because I was like, is this sort of based on the wedding suite in Superman 2 with the fireplace? But that's just my brain wanting everything to be a little bit about Superman 2.
It is a gorgeous suite, though, man. And when I looked at it, I was like, boy, the nicest hotel room I stayed in with my husband didn't have a view of the waterfall. Like, that is like the presidential suite. Selma really is throwing the money around here. You know what? Apparently it's Brad Bird who laid it out. Him slapping around did his.
Yes.
So good. I was just talking to my friend. The way he like flips it up a little bit.
Yeah.
God. Oh, love it. Love it. Bob. Sorry, I feel weird. Keep saying, and Bob did this, and Bob did that. Yeah. No, sorry.
I am also an attempted murderer.
Yeah, so you did.
Sideshow Bob is staring at the fire and saying, like, eradicator of dead wood. Like, oh, Selman, your camera. Like, that's the only reason he has sex with her, because she will stop filming him if they have sex. That's the only reason they do it.
Yeah. And the knock a cavity out was really a surprise to me this time around. I was like, that is a dirty joke. He is going for it. And I guess those feet let you know what's going on down there.
The framing of that shot is hilarious because, you know, obviously we don't see sex. The next shot opens in an empty bathroom. The camera's on the floor. The door slams open and Bob comes in, like, basically giving himself a hobo bath. And we just see, like, Selma's feet sticking out from the room. But if you look, there's a mirror above the ceiling. You can see Selma in that mirror.
Right.
Oh, wow.
Oh, my God. Man, that's an even fancier thing.
Henry, a mirror in the ceiling is not fancy.
Oh,
it's slutty.
I think it's the height of fanciness. Yeah, and I've never had that in a hotel room.
If you see a mirror on the ceiling, definitely sleep on the comforter. That's the most.
I like, too, that Bob had only a second to pull his underpants up just to scrub himself down, like, bleh, bleh. Even murder has its ugly side, he says.
So, Al Jean, or one of the guys on the commentary, said they felt this was a bit unfair. He probably at least enjoyed having sex.
You would think, right? Like, Selma.
Disgusting is Selma?
We're very defensive of that Selma is someone you would want to have sex with. I don't think she's an ugly beast or whatever, but yeah.
Oh, she doesn't shave her legs. Gross.
I was curious about this. One, I was about to say that I'm sure that the voice is doing it for somebody, and that reminded me, of course, of Simpsons porn. In the world of Simpsons porn, which I do not know about, aside from what has been thrown my way on the sideboard of Pornhub, I've never seen Patty and Selma mentioned there, but I'm curious if they ever get up to things.
You know, Steve, I've traveled down many roads, but never have I seen Patty and or Selma involved in any sort of tryst.
Okay, just curious. Mm-hmm.
I'm sure if we wanted to find it, we could.
Yes.
I'm sure it would take probably 5 seconds. But again, I don't feel like whoever had the Simpsons porn pages aren't paying as much as they used to for the, yeah. the placement on the sites that I would mm-hmm. never go to, of course.
No, not at all. I've never seen any of
them. Well, also, they don't show up as much on the gay tabs, I've heard.
It's mainly just Flanders.
Stupid, sexy Flanders.
Should just be Lenny and Carl. Only Lenny and Carl. This is an audio. I think this is the funniest audio joke in the episode. Right here. Oh, and it also starts with Sideshow Bob giving the shutter that will be reused to perfection mm-hmm. a year later.
One of my fillings fell out.
Even murder has its ugly side.
Bob, would you mind rubbing my feet?
Darling, you make it sound like a chore.
Oh, good.
Soon I will kill you.
Huh?
Son pied sentit beau. French for her foot smells lovely.
Oh.
Prepare to be murdered.
Huh?
Pepa de be moudou. That's Sanskrit for your toes are like perfume. Voy a matar a usted.
What?
That's Spanish for I am going to kill you.
Say what?
Why, dear, I do believe it's time for your beloved MacGyver.
Oh, hey, you're right.
That's Spanish for I'm going to kill you. Say what?
Apparently untouched from John Vitti's script.
God, it's so good that he eventually has to say it in Spanish, which is the thing he's trying to not say, and then he just says it again. God damn. I love that entire run.
And Kavner is just, again, really great at the response. Huh? What?
The two of them together have really good acting
chemistry.
They do. Yeah.
They do.
And I also love her rush out of bed holding the blanket up, just like, oh, I can't miss it. It's so ridiculous how long it takes her to realize this. And the way he walks out of the room, too, again, to Steven's point on the lighting, this whole scene is amazing. The angles, his... Yeah. Creeping out, all of it. God.
Everything is just lit by a TV in this dark room.
Yes.
God. Oh, man. So he leaves her to it. This is when Patty, at the same time, is very lonely and heads over to the Simpson home.
Well, time for my walk. Don't forget to die.
Ding dong. I was feeling kind of lonely without Selma. Mind if I watch TV with you?
Oh, go ahead, Patty.
Tonight. On MacGyver.
Aunt Selma has 1 hour to live.
Hey, down in front.
You know, it's weird the things that stick in your brain, but whenever I see MacGyver, I think of Harry Shearer saying, MacGyver.
Yes.
Over and over again in your head. Yeah. Bart's pronunciation of that, too, is a great, like, cut there. Though, of course, in the flashback, you'll see it's just him and Homer talking. So, you know. Hope somebody's fired for that blunder.
Everyone leaves the room.
It's also the same voice as McGarnacle. You know, McGarnacle is very similar. Which I love.
They needed one. There's two McGarnacle appearances. They needed a third, and it would it was cemented him forever.
One is audio only, too.
Right.
Yeah.
Man, that's he'd be right up there with McBain. He deserves it. McGarnacle's just as good as McBain.
I'm trying to eat lunch here is one of my favorite things in the universe.
Slit his throat from the itty.
Do it for me, Billy. We'll get to it.
Yes. This is the bit where I said it's framed like a Columbo opening where it's like slow and quiet.
Yeah, I really appreciate how this story is told in the third act because it's like the explosion is the beginning of the third act. Then you're like, okay, what happened? I mean, I know now because it's been 30 years and I've seen it 100 times, but it's still compelling.
God, it's framed of like pan up. It's at the top. You see her there. Camera moves down. Him turning away from it. Well, that's mm-hmm. Bob's mistake. If he'd have not turned away, he'd have seen Bart save her. Though also, the timing of it doesn't exactly work for Bart to have saved her and then Clancy blows it up. But who cares? Then I love that it's all in one shot, like it would be in a great movie, too, of
yes,
it was intact. And then when the camera pans back up without cutting, it's now the destroyed hotel room.
And there's so much business with the pool and you know what I mean? Like, it's a really full lived in resort that just has. And again, there's no jokes there. It's just like, no, this is atmosphere. We're trying to trick the audience, not really, into thinking she dies, but giving it a gritty texture. I guess we want that Edgar Award really badly.
It's really good. His two-facedness too, where he goes drinking, having a little drink, and then going like, front desk.
He composes himself, just like gets into character as the grieving widow.
Yep.
You know, Fargo ripped it off for its great scene of William H. Macy on the phone. Is he about to call him? It's Gene. It's Gene. But yeah, Sideshow Bob, he celebrates a little too early.
My best laid plans have gang aglay.
Chief Wiggum, think you have room in your jail for a two-time loser?
Well, no, frankly, but that never stopped us before.
Bart, I must know. How did you untangle my web?
Yeah, Bart, pull us in.
Well, I'd hate to tell the number one cop in town how to do his job.
No, no, please. It's the only way I'll learn.
Though also, I forgot to mention, it's a whole Psycho reference, too.
Yes.
Yeah, I mean, I love Psycho, but I feel that 19 times out of 20, people are going to parody the shower scene. So yeah. I forgot this was a Psycho parody of the detective coming to the room, spinning around the chair, and seeing the Mrs. Bates skeleton.
I said it before on this podcast, but I was so lucky. Unlike so many other classic movies where the ending was spoiled for me, I did not know the ending of Psycho when I first saw it as a kid.
Oh, wow.
Wow.
I was like, man, his mom's a killer. Somebody's got to stop this mom.
And also back to what Steve was saying about the lighting again, in that when Bart startles Bob, he smacks a light bulb and that changes the lighting in the scene. Another expensive touch for TV animation that requires a lot of attention to get right.
Yeah, and it's moving back and forth. When Bart actually does save her at the end in this description that he gives, this is when we get the weird Dutch angle of like, Anselma, no! When the Simpsons burst through the door is a really stark, interesting shot for a TV show.
It's a great drawing with a lot of energy. It rules, and a great angle too.
Bob's line of, my best laid plans have gang a flag. That is from the original Scottish version of To a Mouse by Robert Burns, which is usually translated as, the best laid schemes of mice and men go oft awry. But that's how fancy the Sideshow Bob is, that he says gang afteglay instead, the Scottish way of saying it. Also, you tried to kill me, I want a separation.
Yes.
Still wants to give it a shot.
Yeah, yeah. We'll see where it goes.
Sideshow Bob seems so desperate to get that fireplace. But why? Then it hit me. The gas. Surely anyone would have noticed a gas leak. Except Aunt Selma.
I permanently lost my sense of taste and smell.
She happily watched her MacGyver, unaware that her room was silently filling with natural gas. All it needed to explode was a single spark, say, from a cigarette.
I've decided to give up smoking, except for after meals and after MacGyver.
Her only hope was a plucky young boy and his slow-witted father. Dad, when Aunt Selma lights up her cigarette at the end of MacGyver, she'll be blown to kingdom come.
Come again?
See, as Bart explained it all Columbo style.
I love the little bit with the puppets. That's one of those bits that I remember really laughing at as a kid that like just sticks with you. Like, oh, I found this really funny once. And it's still funny. The degradation of like going from, I'll explain it to you, then I'll explain what science is, I'll show you the stove, till we get down to puppets, and he still
doesn't get it. He says four times. Homer's getting dumber every episode of the show. And he's like, and I told Mom, and we were on our way.
Yes.
It just hit me when you said it, Bob. They're like, all right, the sign for plot purposes indicating that they are that close to Shelbyville is in the front lawn across the street.
Yeah.
And of course, because it's John Vitti, half of the John Vitti scripts he wrote for The Simpsons references Batman 66.
Yeah, writer of Mr. Plow.
Yes, yeah. Even in his episodes of The Critic, when the Dr. Krikorian, not Kevorkian, when he gets in his deathmobile, it's also a to the deathmobile. Da-na-na-na-na. In that case, they actually paid for the Batman music. Here, it's just Alf Clausen indicates it, but God, it's so, having to explain it scene by scene, I think they don't go a minute without referencing a movie or a TV show in this episode.
They're
it's
having
so,
fun.
So many.
It's really, really quick with that stuff.
As a kid, though, again, I missed a lot of these references. Never missed a Batman reference. If they referenced Adam West Batman, I knew it.
Kilden syndication in my home. Always loved it.
But I thought it was a serious, real show, and Batman was always in danger. This is when they find out, why did the room explode? In our fun, suffocating ending.
If you saved Selma, why did the room explode?
Oh, I'll feel that one. Me and the boys were all celebrating a job well done when I threw my match in the vicinity of the crime scene. Oh, right, the gas.
I'll be back. You can't keep the Democrats out of the White House forever. And when they get in, I'm back on the streets with all my criminal buddies.
I feel like such a fool.
Well, he fooled almost everyone. But there was one little boy who never lost his mistrust.
Thanks, Mom. Now let's get out of this gas-filled hallway before we all suffocate.
The laughing line that takes you out of every mystery show on TV back then.
Yeah. Yes.
And what Bob didn't know is that Democrats would get into office by imitating Republicans, something that would always work.
Yep.
Never fails.
Yeah.
And yay, you know what? It works so good, too, because after they do that, then the GOP is powerless. They can't say that Democrats aren't tough on crime.
Yeah, yeah.
When they get so tough on crime, then the Republicans go like, now we can't say it.
You got us.
Oh, man.
Now you're really not dirty communists because of your really draconian crime bill. No, not really.
Yeah, no. I mean, hey, we just got to see a little bit of that again. I mean, this happens every day in America, but Biden, when he didn't even need to, but he said he would veto that Washington, D.C. decriminalization of some things. And people were saying, oh, well, he has to. It'll be used against him. And I was like, yeah, they're not going to otherwise. Oh, no. Nope. Like, that's
heaven forbid.
Everything since 2020 has been like, even more so, there's the bad guys on the streets, but it's always the thugs. It sucks. It's bad.
I saw my student loan money back, you old man.
Yeah.
Hand it over, mummy.
Yeah, who knows what SCOTUS has done at this point with that. It's not been finalized yet, right? It's up to the Supreme Court.
Yeah, who deemed it unfair.
Ugh, barf.
You're going to get $40, Bob. It's going to be really exciting.
It's going to be like that Equifax settlement where I got $395 by having all of my details sold all around the world.
It was not the original ending of the episode, too. They mentioned on the commentary, but I had it. This was also posted by, formerly on Twitter, that guy 3002. He quit Twitter, but he owned a lot of the original Simpsons scripts, and I have it word for word from the script. The original exit scene was Selma and Patty on the couch together after all this. Patty says, "So how was it?" And Selma says that it was so good that, quote, "It would have been worth it even if he had blown me up." So Bob was that good.
Or maybe just the love, the attention, perhaps, and the sex.
Sure.
I think that would have worked. I think it works a little bit better. The suffocate line is a bit clumsy for me as an ending. What I think is a really great episode. It just sort of was like, it kind of reminds me of the end of Homer's Triple Bypass with the gas.
Oh, yeah. Or the dental plan one, too.
That's what I mean. Yes, yeah.
It's more just making fun of, which is always fun to do, mocking the bad writing that, though also that, like, Police Squad did 10 years before this of, like, ha, 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 and then go out on a laugh.
Yep.
In this case, it's that they all will suffocate. Though in Dental Plan, in that one, the laughter is much longer and more pronounced. Yeah. They drag it out longer than in this
They had
one.
More time to kill. This one was a too long episode that
That's
things were
right.
cut from.
That's the only reason. A mistake they wouldn't make with Cape Fear. That's a too short one.
Mm-hmm.
Which is why we got the wonderful rakes jokes. I think, too, they probably cut it because they thought the kids watching this aren't going to give a shit about Selma's satisfaction.
Yeah.
The end of this needs to refocus on Bart and how Bart was right. The little boys at home will love that. The moral of the story was one little boy who never lost his mistrust, which also, you know, makes it a sequel to, again, the ending of Krusty Gets Busted, because that ends with Krusty saying, "But there was one little boy who never lost faith in me." And now it's one little boy who never lost his mistrust. Great, great episode. I think the only negatives I feel on it are that every Bob episode after it in the classic years is even better. Like, it builds on this one. But this is such a great, great, great episode.
Yeah, I love it. I mean, I don't really care about the mystery angle because the mystery has been solved, folks. This episode aired in 1992. Amazing direction by David Silverman. The lighting is amazing. The tone is great. And I love Patty and Selma, and getting them involved in a Bob story and also getting Selma involved in another love story, always an A+ in my book. So one of the classics of this season. Steve, any final thoughts on this one?
I agree with what both of you guys say. To Henry's point, I do think the rest of the Bob and the quote unquote classic Bob runs are funnier episodes. Like, I was just watching Sideshow Bob's Last Gleaming, which is such a funny episode. Joke. But this one finds, there's some pathos here. Lonely Selma a little bit, which I always find interesting. Great Kavner acting, I think. There's a little more craft here in terms of actual storytelling as opposed to really hilarious jokes. I'm not made of fucking stone. I prefer the really great jokes. But at the same time, like just from an appreciation angle of an episode, it's been a little while since I've seen this one. It's not such a dour episode or such a serious episode. It's all about the craft. It's still fucking funny. I'm cackling as much as anybody else, but there's a lot here.
Oh, absolutely. Well, thank you for joining us once again, Steve, for your fifth appearance. Once again, we will invoice you for the jackets.
Yeah, I can't wait.
Give it 6 to 8 weeks. but yes, you are also part of We Hate Movies podcast. We love We Hate Movies. You folks are on Patreon. You also have a ton of side content. That's awesome. I might have mentioned the Nexus. If not, that's your Star Trek series and also Melrose 210. That's your 90210 and Melrose Place series. But there's a ton going on. You folks work very hard over there.
Thank you very much. Yeah, we're actually in the middle of Ape Month here. April, I think we're calling it, where we're only doing wonky movies because we're fucking stupid. And that continues. We're doing a virtual live episode on Peter Jackson's King Kong, which will be on April the 20th. Tickets are available for a lot of things. We're actually going to be on tour physically, be in your neck of the woods in San Francisco on May 18th doing Star Trek The Voyage Home at Cobb's Comedy Club. We're going to be on May the 22nd at the Hollywood Improv talking about Twins. And on June 15th, we were doing a Pride event in New Brunswick, New Jersey at the State Theater in New Jersey, a We Love Movies episode on The Birdcage. It's a charity show, and any and all proceeds are going to go to LGBTQ plus New Jersey charities that do a lot of great things for people. We're really excited about that.
I'm so excited you're coming to our neck of the woods. I wish I could go to that Pride one too. That sounds like a lot of fun. And you guys watching The Birdcage, I think it's nice that it's going to be a We Love Movies as well, instead of like for Pride you watch like a really bad thing that's gay. Like, more fun to watch an old thing that's good.
Yeah, you don't want to do gay bashing, would be bad, right?
It's a gay bash. Yeah.
We hate. No, we're...
It's also, I guess, having the word hate at a Pride event probably.
Yeah, that's, you know what, it's been 13 years since we've made that name and we've regretted it ever since.
The hate mongers. I also love your, at the time of this recording, Mandalorian has started up again, and I've been really enjoying your Mandalorian half hour chats on it. It's been
which
amazing.
Run about 45 to an hour an episode. But it's been an interesting season to talk about. I'm curious to see where the hell it's even going, but so far so good.
At the time of this recording, we're only up to chapter 19, so the Coruscant episode just aired. So if it falls off a cliff, Boba Fett style, then we take back any of these nice things we're saying. But I'm a big fan too. Oh, and your YouTube channel. You guys have been doing a lot more on YouTube too.
Thank you so much. YouTube.com/WeHateMovies. We're doing a weekly-ish show on Monday afternoons, recapping box office numbers, doing trailer reactions, and kind of just talking about new stuff we're watching. It's been a lot of fun.
This is how I learned about the Shazam Skittles commercial in the movie, which sounds like shit.
It's
me
tough.
Too.
It's
me too. Jesus Christ.
It's really rough. Taste the Rainbow is uttered twice in that film. It near the climax. Not the climax, but near the climax.
Ugh.
Yeah, gross stuff.
You're watching it so we don't have to.
Yes, thanks. It's public service, Steve. Thanks for being on the show. We appreciate it.
Thank you, guys. It's always a blast. I'd love to come back anytime and do 6, 7, maybe even 8. Ooh. Maybe 8. 8's going to be the top.
We'll talk.
Yes. Yeah, thank you.
Thanks so much to Steve and Sajdak for being on the show. Please check out We Hate Movies and all of their extra content at their Patreon. But as for us, if you want to check out more of what we do and get all these episodes 1 week ahead of time and ad-free, please go to patreon.com/talkingsimpsons. Sign up there for $5 a month. You get just that, but also access to everything behind the $5 paywall that includes new monthly episodes of Talking Futurama and Talking of the Hill, but also access to all of the back episodes of those and a series on Mission Hill, Batman the Animated Series, and The Critic. If you sign up for the Patreon at that $5 level, you get all the miniseries episodes we've done to date for nearly 6 entire years of our Patreon. That's a lot of content waiting for you that you haven't heard if you're not a patron at patreon.com/talkingsimpsons, and there is a $10 level as well. When you sign up for that, you can access all of the $5 stuff naturally, but then you can also access one extremely long podcast once a month only for patrons of that level or higher. And what is that, Henry?
Bob is talking about the What a Cartoon Movie podcast. Yes, once a month we cover an animated feature film just as in-depth as we do an episode of The Simpsons. That often means talking for over 5 hours about an animated feature film, like last month where we talked about Chicken Run, the first Aardman film from the creators of Wallace and Gromit. The month before that, Batman Superman World's Finest. That was a great one as well, talking about the first meeting in the Bruce Timm universe of those two characters. And for April, gonna tell you about it now, folks. We're doing live action again this month. We're breaking format, and we are covering Little Shop of Horrors, the classic musical from the 80s that me and Bob both love to death. So please sign up at that $10 level to hear everything we've done for over 4 years now, over 50 What a Cartoon movies at your fingertips, everything from Akira to a Goofy movie, as I like to say, including our longest podcast we've ever done, 6.5 hours about Who Framed Roger Rabbit. Check it all out for yourself once more at patreon.com/talkingsimpsons.
And I have been one of your hosts, Bob Mackey. You can find me on Twitter as Bob Servo. And my other podcast, by the way, is Retronauts. That's a classic gaming podcast all about old video games. You can find that wherever you find podcasts or go to patreon.com/retronauts. Sign up there for 2 full-length bonus episodes every month. And Henry, how about you?
You can follow me on Twitter at HENEREYG. I'm always tweeting up a storm there about Simpsons and podcasts and politics, too. As well, if you're following me and Bob on Twitter, please follow the official Twitter account of our podcast, at Talk Simpsons Pod. You'll always know when new stuff is happening on the podcast or the Patreon there. And the same goes for Instagram, if you prefer that, at Talk Simpsons Pod on Instagram. Please follow that, too. And if you want an easy-to-follow list of all of the previous released free episodes of Talking Simpsons and What a Cartoon podcast, head over to TalkingSimpsonsPodcast.com.
Thanks so much for joining us, folks. We'll see you again next time for Season 13's The Frying Game, and we'll see you then.
Cutter, ice pick. Snake, I'm going to miss you most of all.
Aww.